their lineup and the pitching of Maxwell and Kilfoyle. Florida State having that 11-game win streak, they're hoping to make it larger. We're going to go to our impact players of the game, Sandra Cox. She's looking to be efficient with her pitches in the circle, and she's a veteran for Florida State.
The lineup for Florida State, a smart, aggressive, and gritty lineup, and it starts with the leadoff batter, Mudge. Mudge, a junior, sets the tone. Loves to take a lot of pitches and battles at the plate. Dak brings a lot of power with 7 home runs, and Flaherty's the hottest hitter from last weekend coming into this lineup. We'll take a look at the Oklahoma State player to watch.
Michaela Work. She had a fantastic weekend last weekend, and she is the Big 12 Player of the Week, somebody that we'll be keeping our eye on.
Defensively for Oklahoma State, from left to right, Edwards, Factor, Carlisle, Bloodworth at third, and maybe the best tandem up the middle with Naomi and Becker. Work at first, the Stillwater native tucked behind the plate, and in the circle, the All-American Kelly Maxwell.
Kelly Maxwell, left-handed pitcher, phenomenal outside pitch for the right-handed hitters. She pitches high 60s, low 70s. She's got a rise that changes planes, a drop, and a change that can keep those Florida State hitters off balance.
We're getting set here for action. Mudge digs in, hitting 377 on the year. Great crowd starting to fill in Cowgirl Stadium. First pitch outside.
When you talk about Mudge in that leadoff spot, she's somebody that loves that pressure. She's somebody who can bunt, she can swing. She's a tough out.
Loves that role, sets the tone for the entire team. That pitch out there on the outside corner for a strike, 1-1 the count. Maxwell going to try to establish herself early, get some confidence, settle in.
That's what the first inning is all about. Kelly Maxwell, veteran of Oklahoma State. You never can tell if she's rattled. She's cool and calm and collected.
One thing with Mudge, a big swing and a miss. But Mudge battles up there. She'll foul off a bunch of pitches. She'll be aggressive at the plate. She'll be selective.
Yep.
And what she does is she allows her teammates to really dial in and get a lot of pitches in there to try to catch the timing.
Yeah, and the more pitches she sees, the better off the information will be that she can pass on to the hitters after her.
1-2 pitch on the way, high. Check swing, they say she went around for the strikeout, so one out.
I think Mudge was a little off balance facing Kelly Maxwell, and you can see she just couldn't hold up on that rise ball, and the umpire right away rings her up.
Great job, call down to the umpire to get the strikeout. Kerr steps in, Janai Kerr. Digs in with one out here in the top of the first. What a weekend for softball here in Stillwater. Pitch down the heart of the plate for a strike. Maxwell jumping ahead in the count.
It does have that feel of a postseason game. Number 6 against number 3. And the home crowd for Oklahoma State as it gets later is just tremendous.
Fans continuing to pour in the standing room only area, the 0-1, swing and a miss. And right now the Florida State hitters really trying to find a way to adjust to Maxwell.
Yeah, the adjustment that needs to be made is they need to see that ball out of Kelly Maxwell's hand, closer to her hip. On the left side, you get a little bit better read of Maxwell's hip. On the right side, she hides the ball well for those right-handed hitters.
Heading the count, 0-2. A big swing and a miss, a second strikeout of the game for Maxwell.
Maxwell goes back to that rise ball against the lefty, and you can just see she swings well underneath that pitch.
Harding up, the right fielder. Harding hitting from the right side. Had a couple lefties in there, start out. First pitch, low and outside.
And this is where Kelly Maxwell is effective against these right-handed hitters. She hides that ball so well and keeps it on the outside part of the plate. When OSU played Missouri last weekend, we saw the Missouri hitters with their toes on the chalk as close as they could to home plate to take away that outside pitch from Maxwell.
That ball hit well to left. That's going to be over the head of Kylie Naomi for a single. So that'll be the first hit of the game for the runner at first.
Let's look and see where Harding was able to catch that ball. She was a little bit under it and off the end of her bat, which resulted in the bloop, and Naomi going back hard, as hard as she can. She's one of those veterans in the lineup for Oklahoma State, wasn't able to come up with it.
Dak comes up, 7 home runs, leading the team with a .426 average. I'm gonna run her at first with 2 outs. What a tough play over the head of Naomi. Track it back, and Edwards did a nice job of keeping it in front.
Yeah, with Edwards playing a little bit deeper, it's hard to get those bloops, and that's why Naomi goes back so hard, and she's so aggressive. You can just see how much passion is in the game when she goes back that hard.
Dak has 19 RBIs this season. 1 ball, no strikes.
And there's that outside pitch from Maxwell. The umpire sees it and calls it a strike.
It's interesting early on, the umpire starting pitcher dynamics, just trying to establish
right
where that zone is.
Right, and that's where the offense wants to see a lot of pitches too. And of course you want to be ready to swing early against Maxwell. She's not going to make a lot of mistakes. You might get one good pitch and you're at bat and you've got to be ready to swing.
2 on the count. Tuck behind the plate, Stillwater native, veteran. So this combination of Maxwell Tuck, used to working together.
This battery has been together quite a long time.
2-1 pitch fouled off, 2-2 the count. Dak dialed in, swinging for her pitch. Pop, a lot of power in that swing.
Tons of power. Dak is somebody in the lineup to keep your eye on. She's somebody that can make things happen. So Oklahoma State defense needs to be ready to make the play.
Two pitch, ground ball to third. Bloodworth up, fires to first in time for the out. So that'll retire the Florida State here in the top of the first. You're watching Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus. Around the infield, Hartley. You have Muffley, Flaherty, Leonard, Edenfield behind the plate, and Sandercock in the circle.
Sandercock in the circle. She's developing a rise and a change, so she's going to rely mainly on her curve. She's anywhere from 66 to 69 miles per hour, and we are going to look for her to be efficient with her pitches.
Well, veteran, a two-time All-American. And this is a big-time atmosphere, and something Becker, who was an All-American last year at Purdue, came in here. She's seeing the ball well. She's on an 18-game hitting streak. She's actually reached base in all 19 games that she's been a Cowgirl.
And she has the second longest hit streak behind Taylor Lynch, which is amazing because she's been here not even a year yet.
And Lynch actually set that her freshman year.
Oh, did she? Oh, wow.
So Becker steps in.
And Becker is somebody who sets the tone for the offense for these OSU hitters. She's also somebody who sees a lot of pitches and gets a lot of good information for the batters after her.
Great examples, if you're watching this game, of leadoff batters. They do everything right on both sides. That first pitch was a called strike on the outside corner. Look at the focus and the approach that Becker takes at the plate.
And Becker's somebody who can lay down a bunt. We saw that this last weekend, and she's got some speed and can beat that out. So Florida State corners need to be ready for that as well.
Edenfield, the catcher, a sophomore, had a really great year as a freshman, back behind the plate for Florida State. Sandercock ahead in the count, 0-2. Fouled off. Becker brings a lot to the table. Defensively, that combination with her and Naomi up the middle,
yeah,
one of the best in the country, but just from a confidence, she's a grad transfer, she's a mature, older player.
Well, anytime you have 1 year left and you come into a program and you fit in so well right away, and Coach Gajewski saw that and rewarded her with the leadoff position, and he said, hey, you know what? I don't need another shortstop. I know you're a shortstop, but I really need a second baseman. Can you play second base? And she's so selfless and team-oriented. She's like, yeah, I can play second base, no problem.
One ball, two strikes. It's all about the team, the whole team concept. Both sides preach we're doing things as a team, as a unit, not individuals. Sandercock in the 1-2. Outside, 2-2. Pettenfield working behind the plate. Again, trying to establish that relationship. You hear a little influence
little
from the fans.
There.
Yeah. Two pitch, fouled back to the hit back to the pitcher. Sandercock fields her position, throws her out at first for the first out. Ball just barely off the end of the bat. Number
Becker
right
just,
up the middle.
Becker just caught that drop ball, barely tipped it, and that's why it went back to the pitcher.
Look at the conversation going on the on-deck circle between Becker and Edwards.
Yeah.
A little insight of what she just faced.
The information passing is invaluable. Anytime that you can have a little bit of an insight to the opposing pitcher, it makes you that much more ready to get in the box.
Talon Edwards fouls that one off, and that hurts.
Oh yeah, anytime it hits bone, I mean, anytime it hits anywhere at this point, it hurts. You're gonna see it's kind of a down and in pitch. Edwards just tops that right into her ankle, it looks like. Yeah, that's gonna feel good today and tomorrow. Ooh, yeah, on the side of her foot.
Rubs a little dirt on it, she's good.
Oh, yeah. Tape an aspirin to it.
There you go. Outfielder, graduated early.
Yeah, she's somebody that Coach Gajewski has a lot of respect for and has taken over somewhat that fatherly figure for Edwards.
Oof. Inside, called strike, 0-2.
Sandercock going back inside and seeing, you know, if I can get that across the plate, I bet Talon Edwards is not going to swing at that after fouling that one, that last one off into her foot. And she's doing well. With Becker, she went outside. With Edwards, she's coming inside, keeping the ball low.
That ball fouled down the first baseline. That's an aggressive approach with two strikes on her from Edwards.
Yeah, with two strikes, you've got to be ready to foul anything off that isn't a good strike and be ready for that next pitch.
It's a good combination of being aggressive but being selective.
Yeah, with two strikes, you can't be too selective. You just have to make sure that at this point you understand what the umpire's strike zone is so that you can put a good swing on a good pitch.
0-2 pitch. Hit into center. That's going to be caught by Kerr. Kerr had a nice read on that ball. Came in and made the play. It's going to be one out, but two outs now. Kylie Naomi, the senior. Lafayette, Louisiana, 5'7".
Maybe if she was 5'8", she could have caught that ball in the outfield.
Not for lack of effort, that's for sure.
That's
everything
for sure.
She does is 100%.
100%. And she's somebody who has kind of bounced up and down in the lineup for Oklahoma State. Last year she was leadoff, and now she's at the three position.
That pitch inside, fouled off. Sandercock going inside, last couple hitters.
Yeah, she's doing well establishing that inside and outside part of the plate. Then she also has that rise ball she goes to as well. So it's hard because when she's moving the ball inside and outside and establishing that strike zone, you can't move off of the plate very much because then that makes you vulnerable for that outside pitch.
Ground ball to third, picks it up, fires to first in time for the out. So that will retire the inning for Oakland.
All these stats, that's why you're here.
Well, she has over 800 wins in her career. She's a Hall of Famer. She won a national championship in 2018, and she's been to four Women's College World Series. So, I mean,
she's been there, done that.
Yeah, every step of the way, she's been there. And Kenny Gajewski is right there. You start looking at his track. Both of them have been to regionals, World Series, and it just kind of keeps growing from there. We're in the top of the second inning here. Flaherty will lead it off for Florida State. Maxwell still in the circle. Big swing and a miss. Flaherty last weekend, 583, seven hits, scored six times, and had seven RBIs.
That's nuts. I mean, you have to put somebody after Dak. The Dak attack, if she gets on and hits the ball well, or if you're going to pitch around her, you have to have somebody behind her that can come in and do a job, and it sounds like last weekend she did that.
1-1 the count. I mean, with both these lineups, but specifically with Florida State, Flaherty's at the plate, Mack Leonard's on deck.
Right.
And then Muffley's after her. So, I mean, they can make things happen and produce runs and manufacture runs as they need to.
They have a murderer's row, but then you face somebody like Kelly Maxwell, who's somewhat dominant in the circle. And it's, you know, we talked about, is it going to be a hitter's duel? Is it going to be a pitcher's duel? And at this point, I mean, we're still early in the game, but both pitchers being efficient in the circle and getting the outs when they need it. Defense playing behind them.
3-1 the count. Now, from a hitter standpoint, what's your mindset in that first at bat?
Oh, I'm just going to go up there and kill the ball. No. So what I'm going to do, I mean, if I'm that leadoff hitter, yeah, I'm going to see as many pitches as I can. But when you're in the dugout, you have to be paying attention as well, because if you're not prepared by the time you get to that on-deck circle, you're not prepared to get into that box. So the preparation happens well before you're in the box.
3-1 pitch was in there for a called strike. So a full count now to Flaherty. She digs in. She's in the backside of that box.
That seems to be where most of the batters nowadays end up.
High and outside, ball four.
And those leadoff walks, you hope those leadoff walks don't come back to haunt you. That's a pitcher's worst nightmare right there. You don't want to have that leadoff walk.
Mack Leonard now steps to the plate. You look at Flaherty on the bases. 14 of 14.
She's kind of quick.
So we know that they're going to be aggressive on the base paths. They're going to be smart and intentional.
But then you have the two shortstops playing middle infield for Oklahoma State. They work well together. They turn double plays together. They have a really good working relationship out there. The communication is good.
You know, watching the tendencies and what happens here with Flaherty, you know she's aggressive at first. That first pitch to Leonard was fouled down the right field line. Heading the count 0-1, pitch on the way. Down, stolen base on the way, number 15. And that was pretty easy with the ball low and away. A great jump, and Florida State has a runner at second.
Well, not only did she get a great jump, but like you said, that pitch was a little bit down and out, and the throw to second base is a little bit off. It's a little high and not quite to the bag.
So 15.
15 of 15 stolen bases for Flaherty.
1-1 the count to Mack. Pitch, low, 2-1.
And this is where the Oklahoma State defense, they want to get that ball on the ground, take a look at the runner on second, throw to first.
As a defender, are you going through the scenarios before the pitch?
I think you have to. That preparation necessary for the ball. If the ball gets hit to me, what am I going to do with it?
That 2-1 pitch, low and inside, 3-1 now. Edenfield's on deck, the catcher. Had 16 home runs as a freshman last year.
And on paper, Oklahoma State and Florida State are very similar with their batting averages, their RBIs. The only thing that really stands out as different is the doubles hit by Florida State.
3-1 pitch inside, and another walk, ball four. So two on, runners at first and second for the sophomore Edenfield.
But you can see Maxwell, she's really not rattled. She has a great defense behind her, and Naomi's talking and saying, okay guys, this is what we're gonna do. And this is a situation if the ball is hit to third base, you touch third base, throw to one, and you've got a double play right there.
Edenfield digs in. Again, Maxwell now has given up two straight walks. That pitch low and outside.
Just missing that outside corner. I think at this point, there's been two batters before you. Adam Fields in the box. There's two runners or batters before you who have walked. You know you've got to be a little bit patient and let Kelly Maxwell bring it to you.
Bedenfield, one of the top freshmen in all the country last year, a finalist for freshman of the year. So that pitch was in there for a strike, 1-1 the count. Kind of wonder, are they looking to move the runners over? They're going to let her swing away with the power. I imagine they're going to let her swing away early. Ground ball to third. She tags third. What a play before the first.
Wasn't able to be scooped up.
Couldn't pull it out of her glove. But what a play by Bloodworth to make the play, tag third for the automatic out.
That ball low and in. Edenfield goes over the top. Bloodworth just tags her glove on that base. And that's one where you want that double play so bad that the throw just isn't quite as good as it needs to, but Work's got to come up with that.
A great effort by Work at first, yes, just to get out there and try to make that play for the double play. But Bloodworth, the hot corner, fearless over there, made the play, smart to tag third. One out on the board, runners at first and second. That ball flared out to right. Carlisle's there, makes the catch, fires in, keeps the runner at second. And what a heads-up play.
And that's a good time to hold the runner at second base and see what kind of an arm we have in right field. And you can see that was kind of a gun. She was behind the ball, coming through the ball, so you knew she was going to have momentum throwing towards third base already. So that was a good play to have the runner stay at second base.
Looks like we might have a pinch runner potentially over. We'll see what happens here as we're going through the lineup. And we're going to have a pinch hitter.
Early in the game,
Waycaster. Waycaster steps in, and she's been a starter for them the last couple of weeks now. She earned her way into the starting lineup, so that's not surprising. We will have to see the adjustments now defensively. That pitch low and outside. So Waycaster for Hartley.
She's somebody who swings well. So early in this game, Florida State is going ahead and using that pinch hitter, wanting to get ahead early in this game against Oklahoma State.
The 1-0 pitch is in there for a called strike. So Waycaster, 1-1. Two outs. So Maxwell's trying to work her way out of giving up the first two walks. 1-1 pitch. That ball hit up the middle. That'll go to left. Edwards comes up with it, fires home, play at the play. And she's not in time as a run will score. That was a play at the plate. Tuck had about 4 feet behind home plate to make the catch and then try to apply the tag.
Yeah, it's tough because you can't be in front of the plate. You have to give the runner that lane to be able to slide. And Edwards' throw was just a little bit off. So that's why we had Tuck go ahead and be behind that plate to make that plate. And Tuck needed to make sure she didn't let that ball get to the backstop and have somebody else on third base.
Yeah, kept the runners at first and second. That's the 13th RBI of the season for Waycaster. Two outs still, 1-0 lead for Florida State. That pitch is low, ball one.
We're back at the top of the lineup with Mudge. Struck out her first time up, so she's second time through the lineup, making those adjustments so she doesn't get fooled with that rise ball. Or the drop ball, I guess, right? Yeah, it's tough. You get in those situations, and with two outs, you want to be aggressive, but you also have to be smart about those swings.
1-1 the count. Now you really get into the adjustments and dig in there. Ball two, 2-1. Handful of pitches for Maxwell this inning.
I think it's more pitches than she wants to in the second inning. I mean, she's at 33 pitches. She's walked two already this inning. Ooh, close.
3-1 now. You hear the boo birds, everybody kind of questioning where that zone went.
Well, of course, you've got your home field advantage back there, right? Boo, that was a strike.
3-1 the count. Runners at first and second with two outs. Pitch on the way, ground ball to second. Becker has it. She'll tag Wakehaser at, between first and second for the third out, and that will retire the side for Florida State, but not before they pick up a run and take a one.
He's somebody this year who has established what the Cowgirl way is. It's relentless, it's excellence, and it's passionate, and I know when they're down just even a little bit, he can go back to those words and say, okay, who are we? This is who we are, and this is how we play. And it'll be interesting to see how Oklahoma State responds to Florida State scoring first.
You know, Kenny Gajewski, his eighth season, he's taken the Cowgirls to three consecutive World Series, and he's established a culture here that they believe anytime they play, they can win. And that confidence is through the lineup.
Yep. When it comes to the confidence Oklahoma State has, I mean, that's somewhat earned. They've gone to the World Series the last of, you know, my stat guy would know this, the last 4 years, something like that, and it's something that's expected now. When Coach Gajewski first came in, it was, you know, we just want to get to postseason, we want to host, and now it's a mainstay of, we want to get to the Women's College World Series.
Now, defensively for Florida State, Wakehaser came in for Hartley in the ninth spot. She actually takes over in right. The right fielder in Harding is now playing third. Sander Cox in the circle. And will face Wark, the Big 12 Player of the Week. First pitch, a strike. Sander Cox ahead in the count. You see the World Series.
Just a few of them out there. And they pop so well off the back black drop.
No balls, one strike. Sander Cox pitch, fouled down the third baseline. Work behind in the count, 0-2.
Big 12 Player of the Week coming and wanting to show, you know what, I earned that and I want to continue to earn that.
Work's a gal that's rotated between first and that DP spot. And it's getting to a point where you have to have her bat in the lineup.
Yep.
0-2 pitch, ground ball to third. Harding comes up with it, fires to first. That'll go over the first baseman's head. That'll be an error on the third baseman. And that's tough. She just got into the game, moves from right to third.
Right to third, yeah.
Gets a ball, throws it away.
It's hard because in the outfield, you release it so much higher up. And then in the infield, you've got to throw kind of a line drive. And you can see she just releases it a little bit too early like she would in right field. And it just goes soaring.
Now, as you're trying to learn the field for Florida State, you're looking at how that ball bounces back.
Exactly. And knowing there's not a, I mean, Wark does have some speed, but when it bounces back quickly, Wark has to stay at first base.
Carlisle at the plate. She's a junior from Purcell, Oklahoma, a returning All-American, hitting 347.
She's been clutch for Oklahoma State. Came in primarily as a pitcher and hitter. And when Coach Gajewski said, you know what, let's try her in the outfield, then he went, okay, well, she can play outfield. Let's keep her there.
The 1-0 pitch, big swing and a miss. You know, talk about her arm, that ball that was hit to right, that little flare to right, she came up with and kept the runner at second.
Yep. She's got a gun out there. I know she's not somebody that Coach Gajewski thought would do well out there, but she's earned that position, and she definitely has worked on her arm and getting in the weight room and strengthening that up.
1-1 pitch fouled off. 1-2. We are in the bottom of the second. Leadoff runner on with no outs. Reached on in a throwing error. Sander Cox has really kind of been able to do what she wants.
She's been moving the ball in and out, and it's worked so far. But we're only in the bottom of the second.
1-2 pitch popped up, shallow right field. Right fielder comes in. Wakeheser makes the catch for the first out. Factor due up. Again, the conversation's still going on as Carwell comes over, talks with Factor, gives her a little heads up.
You know, those pops to right field with somebody on base, that's tough because you have to get off just enough to where you can get back. But if they drop the ball, you have to be off enough to take that next base. So being able to read the ball and where it's at, that starts with how the hitter contacts that ball and where it goes.
Pitch in there for a called strike. Factor hitting 386.
She's another one of the veterans in the Oklahoma State lineup. She's been in center field for many years now.
Finds a way to make things happen. That's what Kenny Gajewski said.
She's a playmaker.
1-1. He just said she finds a way, whatever it is. Even if she's not seeing the ball well, she'll find a way to get on. She'll find a way to create a spark to get a run. Whatever needs to happen, the veteran finds a way. And an Oklahoma gal, Oklahoma, UConn, Oklahoma. Work still on first, 1-1 pitch. Low for ball two. You know, Oklahoma State really limited on their, they have 24 stolen bases. You feel like you're at a point where you have great hitters, you're gonna let them hit away early in the game.
I think Oklahoma State, you know, their batting averages are so high, you have to play those averages.
Two, one pitch outside, 3-1. This is a respect situation, senior to senior.
Right. And we talked with Lonnie Alameda earlier this week and kind of said, you know, well, what's your pitching rotation? Who's gonna start, who's gonna come in? And she literally said, it's gonna be all hands on deck.
A drastic change in the game of softball from being one or two arms
right.
to an actual pitching staff. That ball hit up the middle. Second baseman comes up with it. There's going to be a fielder's choice based off Wark going away from the fielder.
And you and I talked about that in between innings. What should a runner do if they find themselves getting to a point where they're going to get tagged and back up and away from that defensive player? You want to make them come to you. Don't make it easy for them, but then you can see Wark going ahead and getting tagged out at second base. But she made him earn it, right?
Well, Wark went back. Flaherty was trying to make a play, a heads-up play by her when the ball got away to pick it up and get the out at second.
Right.
So they still accomplished getting the lead run out for two outs, but just an interesting...
They did it creatively, right?
No doubt. Two outs, first pitch. It's in there as a ball to win. Wynn, a second-year player here, started her career at Kansas.
Yeah, Wark and Wynn, both Kansas transfers, and they've both been in competition for first base.
One ball, no strikes, two outs. 2-0. So both pitchers here struggling a little bit with the strike zone.
And Lonnie Alameda coming out and just wants to check in with their pitcher, maybe slow down the game a little bit.
Looks like Emma Wilson warming up for Florida State.
I think that's the all hands on deck is what Alameda talked about. And you just wonder how long she'll let Sendercock go. I mean, she's doing well right now. She's keeping Oklahoma State to no runs and hasn't had a walk yet. So you just got to wonder, is she just going to let Sendercock go until Oklahoma State gets up on her, or she's going to change things up before that happens.
In reality, as with some of these young pitchers, they may be actually just putting in some bullpen time.
That's true. I mean,
especially early, but to have an arm warming up just in case you need it. Wins ahead in the count 2-0, runner at first. 1-0 lead for Florida State. That pitch is a called strike. A chilly night, but a nice night here in Stillwater.
No rain.
1, Oklahoma State 0. Let's look at the series history. Oklahoma State leads 13-11. And last year down in Tallahassee, Florida State took both of those games by one run. And this has been an epic battle and typically a postseason battle. In 19, Oklahoma State defeated the Noles down in Tallahassee to win the Super Regional and start the World Series run. And then in 21, Florida State eliminated Oklahoma State. So this has become a little bit of a postseason rivalry.
Well, I love the atmosphere that comes even before conference. It's like they're already gearing up, both teams gearing up for the run postseason.
Maxwell still in the circle. And that'll bring up Kerr. Kerr's 0-for-1 with a strikeout, hitting 388. Maxwell looking into the dugout, getting the signs, hitting the count 0-1. Florida State on the day, one run, two hits. That pitch high, 1-1. They do have one error. Oklahoma State, no runs and no hits.
You know, we talked about keys of the game earlier, before the game even started, and you know, I said Oklahoma State's got to come out and play defense and offense well. Come out early in the count offensively, and it looks like Florida State beat them to that.
That pitch in there for a called strike. 1-ball, 2 strikes. We knew Florida State was going to come out and be aggressive. We talked to Lonnie all week, and she was talking about how we're going to play our game.
Right.
And so we knew that they were going to have that mindset coming into this game. Low and inside, 2-2. And what an opportunity to talk to Coach Alameda during the week. Just, you know, a great hospitality.
Yeah.
Was open.
Oh, yeah.
You know, was more about like, kind of like what they're going to do versus what the Oklahoma State's going to do. It's kind of fun to see and talk to a coach of that magnitude on that level. 2-2 pitch, foul down the left field line. Good chase by Edwards, but out of play. And you turn around and I talked to Kenny yesterday. I had a chance to hit batting practice. And, you know, Kenny's all about the approach. Every pitch, every inning, everything's about do your job, make it happen. It's just fun when you have softball at such a high level.
Yeah, and when you get to where Coach Gajewski is, you do have to pay attention to those details. Every pitch, every swing, every defensive play. Those are the things that are going to make the difference between if you're number 3 or number 30 in the RPI.
That pitch low and inside, full count. Maxwell looks in. Pitch, big swing and a miss. That'll be her 3rd strikeout of the game.
Kelly Maxwell throwing that drop ball hard on the inside part. Actually, it went about over the plate, but Kerr not able to hold up. That's one of those when you're in the back of the box, you just really can't catch up to it. But you have to be in the back of the box with Maxwell when she's throwing 70 miles an hour.
Harding due up, stepping in right now. She had a single to left. The bloop single over Kylie Naomi, her first time up. That pitch high for a ball. How do you make that adjustment? You're used to being on the back. You need to scoot up.
Yeah, that's tough. Usually you just scoot up with the pitchers that are maybe a little bit slower or you know have an off-speed pitch. When you're throwing about 70 miles an hour, you just really can't.
Ball hit to left. Edwards camps out and makes the catch. 2 outs. Edwards end up being in a pretty good spot. Took about 3 steps and made the catch.
And without the wind blowing tremendously out there, it's an easy play. It's an easy read.
I'm sure the social was helping her all along.
Oh, absolutely. the fans out there in left field are just tremendous. Chilly, a little wind, gusting at 9 miles an hour, but not much. Low and outside to Dak. Everything away from Dak so far. Dak 0 for 1, grounded out to third, her first time up. There's a little bit of a respect when you're hitting over 400. We want to make sure we keep that ball where Dak either can't reach it or can't be successful with a swing.
Two and oh. Dak from Parker, Colorado. Just a sophomore. Two and oh, big swing and a miss.
Outside drop ball. A mindset of a hitter. You know, that pitcher's got to bring me something good. She's already behind with two balls. So you've got to be ready to swing. You're saying yes, 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 and no at the very last second if that ball is not a good strike.
2-1 the count. Maxwell gets the sign, pitch on the way. Check swing. They say she went around, strike two. Couple different check swings here early.
Dak had one, Mudge had one the first inning. So it's like they're not quite sure what Kelly Maxwell's bringing to the table, which is good if you're the pitcher. Keep them off balance.
A big swing and a strikeout for strike three, and that will retire Florida State. We're heading to the bottom of the third. Florida State leads 1-0 here in Stillwater. You're watching Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus.
Get help reaching your goals with JP Morgan Wealth Plan, a new tool in the Chase mobile app. Use it to set and track your goals, big and small, and see how changes you make today could help put them within reach. From your first big move to retiring poolside and the other goals along the way, Wealth Plan can help you get there. JP Morgan Wealth Management.
How do I love thee? Let me count the ways.
Love can get a little messy. Good thing there's Resolve. Love the love, resolve the mess.
There's never been a better time to get away with a great deal on the Hyundai you've always wanted. You know, it didn't come to play. With America's best warranty and up to 3 years complimentary maintenance. It's your journey. Own every mile at the Hyundai Getaway Sales Event. Now's the time to get in and get away. Get 0% APR financing plus zero payments for 90 days on select Hyundai vehicles. See your Southern California Hyundai dealers.
When cold symptoms keep you up, try Vicks NyQuil Severe. Just one dose starts to relieve 9 of your worst cold and flu symptoms to help take you from 9 to none. For max strength nighttime relief, NyQuil Severe. The nighttime sniffling, sneezing, coughing, sore throat, best sleep with a cold medicine.
Welcome back to Stillwater. We're set for the bottom of the third inning, and let's take a look at what Florida State has been able to do.
Florida State's just been a tremendous program. Anytime you can get to the World Series 11 times, that says a lot about where your program is.
Talking about the 2018 National Championship, the first in school history, 18 ACC championships, and 35 All-Americans. And the ACC is actually getting a lot better, but Florida State is still the team to beat. And we talked a little bit about RPI with both coaches, and with the ACC getting better,
yeah.
Coach Alameda feels like there's more RPI wins within conference, but they still are the team to beat in the ACC.
Definitely, definitely. But anytime you have a strong conference that's getting stronger, that just gives you more confidence moving forward to the postseason that you've seen who you need to be prepared.
Due up here in the bottom of the third for Oklahoma State, the Stillwater native, Taylor Tuck. Sandercock still in the circle. Ball one. And Tuck hitting 320. Hometown gal. Four RBIs. 800 on base. Taylor Tuck is a gal that just has continued to get better during her career here.
Yeah, she split time last year at catcher and now seems to be the starting catcher for Oklahoma State.
Ground ball to first. Bobbles it, picks it up. Mack Leonard makes the play for the out. Nice focus for Mack Leonard not to let that one go.
That's an easy one to flub when you're waiting for it to come to you. You might even want to take a step to go to the ball. Don't let the ball play you, right?
She's all smiles. She said it was easy.
She's like, what? I got the out.
Yeah. What were you guys thinking? I had it all away.
I was confident.
Bloodworth due up, stepping in. She's played a great third base.
She has. She's somebody that has taken over for Sydney Pennington at third base and done well.
First pitch into third. Fires to first in time for the out. So Oklahoma State has now made their way through the lineup as Becker comes up.
You know, second time through the lineup, what are those things that you need to make adjustments on? And I think Oklahoma State is swinging at Sandercott's pitches and not waiting for their pitch. You have to be ready early in the count, but Sandercott just doing a really great job of keeping that ball down and on the corners.
Handful of ground balls on the drop ball.
Yeah.
You know, what point you roll over that versus get underneath and try to drive it up the middle.
Right, you've got to get your hands down to that.
That first pitch fouled off.
If you can get your hands down to the plane of the ball, then you're more successful at driving it rather than rolling over it and having that ground ball out.
You heard a couple of coaches talk about making the adjustments, either moving up on the drop ball and trying to focus, you know, shortstop to second base, driving the ball up
the
middle.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And a lot of that comes back to the contact. Where are you letting that ball get deep enough to where you can drive it up the middle? Or are you hitting it too far out in front?
That pitch fouled off, 0-2.
I like that Rachel Becker went to a bunt. You just have to wait for a pitch that's a little bit better. When you're in a bunt situation or somebody who bunts, you want to bunt a pitch that you can be successful at, and that's got to be a pretty darn sweet pitch down the middle.
Ground ball to third. Picks it up, fires to first in time. So 1-2-3 for Oklahoma State in the bottom of the third. We head to the top of the fourth. Still 1-0 Florida State. You're listening to Big 12 Now. And then Lexi Kilfoyle is just, I mean, she is a dominating pitcher. She can come in. We expect to see her this weekend. But she's going to take the Big 12 by storm.
Absolutely. And anytime you have coaches like John Barfield and Whitney Clower, you have coaches who are invested in getting you better as a hitter and getting you better as a pitcher.
So Flaherty, the second baseman, due up here for Florida State. She walked her last time up, but picked up her 15th stolen base.
Speedy Flaherty. And when you've got somebody in the box and you know she has speed, that puts all of the pressure on the defense. You have to come up and you have to make the play perfectly.
Maxwell in the circle, first pitch. Oof. Looked like it might have hit her.
I thought maybe it bounced up and hit the umpire in the basket. Hit something. You know, you
one
and
ball.
I talked about during the break, wondering if maybe Kelly Maxwell is working on some technique issues, because a lot of those ones that she's missing, I mean, they really miss. That's not something that's characteristic that we've seen in the past.
One ball, no strikes. Pitch on the way inside, 2-0. It's not like she's missing by an inch here. When she misses, there's big misses.
It's a huge miss.
And in this type of ball game, a miss could be a home run. It could be a run.
Yeah, and that's exactly right. Yeah, and Kelly Maxwell, she usually does very well getting ahead in the count, and she's been behind in the count frequently this game.
That pitch outside, 3-0. You definitely don't want to get into the habit of leadoff walks.
No. As good as your defense is, you don't want to put any more pressure on them.
Flaherty sitting at 3-0, looking for a second walk of the game. Mac Leonard on deck. That's high, ball four. So four straight pitches leads to her second walk. That's the third walk allowed for Maxwell this game. Mac Leonard up, hitting 278, a couple of home runs, 18 RBIs, and the speed of Flaherty on it first.
Pitch. You know, normally against Kelly Maxwell, I would say look early in the count. But at this point, I would almost think, I'm going to sit back and wait for a strike before I start to swing.
Five straight balls to start this inning for Maxwell. Some action down in the Oklahoma State bullpen as well. Pitch on the way, outside, ball two. At some point, you're going to have to let your defense help you.
Exactly.
You're probably in a take situation anyway, based off the balls, but you're going to have to get back in battle in the count.
Yeah. At some point, you're just going to have to put the ball over the plate and preferably lower in the zone so it stays in the ball field.
Pitch on the way. There it is. 2-1. That's your classic take. Leonard scored the only run of the game. It's 1-0 Florida State. She ended up walking and scoring on the RBI single in the second. 2-1 pitch coming up for Maxwell. Inside, Flaherty takes second. 16 now.
And she ran on almost the same pitch as last inning, something down where Tuck had to go down and get it, and it's hard to make that throw when it's down like that. The transfer and that ball thrown just to the left side of the field.
When you're aggressive like Florida State and that ball hits the dirt, there's no chance. Pitch on the way, 3-1, ball four. Leonard walks.
And it didn't look like Flaherty was going from the pitch. She got a great jump and then saw the ball was down and took off. So that's great ball awareness right there.
Coach Alameda talked about that. She said it's all about the reads.
It's all about the read in the outfield and the infield, and then as a runner. Getting that many doubles, you really have to be aware of at the plate. If the ball gets through, you got to be thinking two right out of the box.
And when you lead the nation in doubles, right, everybody's thinking two out of the box.
Oh, yeah.
Edenfield, the catcher, in the seventh spot. That pitch fouled over the top. Now ahead in the count, 0-1. And Edenfield aggressive right out of the bat.
Yeah, I think she was thinking, if Kelly Maxwell brings me anything up in the zone, I'm going to swing at that pitch. Which is interesting because we had two walks before, so she had a strategy that I wouldn't use, but she was ready. I love her in the box, just going for it.
1-1 the count, that pitch just misses. A similar situation here in the fourth that started in the second. Walk, brings up Edenfield. Does have power. Still only one run on two hits for Florida State. Maxwell hanging tough, pitch on the way, big swing and a miss.
And last inning, this is when Edenfield hit the ball towards third base. Bloodworth tags the bag, goes one, almost a double play.
What a heads-up play.
Yeah, it's almost deja vu right here.
And you can look where Bloodworth's at, lined almost even with the bag.
Yeah, playing just a little bit behind it.
1-2. High and inside, 2-2. The wind, one of 5 days a year that the wind doesn't blow at the stadium, and here it is tonight. Tomorrow is supposed to be a beautiful day for a 2:00 game. Still a lot of softball here tonight. We're in the fourth. Florida State leads 1-0. 2-2 pitch. Just missed inside. 3-2. Interesting dynamic as you're missing balls and strikes really close inside. You have Tuck trying to do a good job with the relationship with the umpire. You got Maxwell probably thinking that was strike three.
Hoping it was.
Full count on the way. That ball hit well into left center. That ball is out of here. That's going to be a three-run shot for Edenfield and Florida State. And that ball was a no-doubter right off the bat. And that's a three-run home run.
The outfield barely moved for that ball. I mean, that ball was, I think it landed on the street behind the stadium. Ball up in the zone. Edenfield just goes and gets it, and she's got enough power. She knew as soon as it came off of her bat, she said, let's go.
Edenfield, that's her fourth home run of the year, 19th RBI. That kind of opens this thing up a little bit at 4-0. It's crazy in a tight game like this. You make one mistake, you leave a ball up.
Exactly, yeah, that's exactly right. That's how fast ball games can change, is with one swing.
And it's really not the home run that kills you, it's the two walks prior.
Exactly, those walks.
Muffley, the shortstop at the plate.
You know, throwing that rise ball to Edenfield, I think that one just has to climb the ladder just a little bit more, and I know why she went back to that rise ball. Having that foul ball off of the rise ball back out of the stadium, you would go back to that and see if you can make her miss, but it's got to climb the ladder just a little bit more.
Miss bunt attempt there by Muffley. No balls, one strike. That ball fouled off. 0-2 the count. So now you're looking at a 4-0 ball game.
Right.
At this point, you still have no outs on the board. You're trying to get out of this inning and get back to the plate.
Yeah, you want short defensive innings at this point for Oklahoma State.
And Florida State, now you have a little breathing room. Now you can play a little bit. That's a ground ball to third. Bloodworth up with it, fires to first in time, one out.
There's a little bit of breathing room, and I think if Oklahoma State hitters can make the adjustment of getting a better pitch to drive or doing something technical to get your hands on plane with the ball, they can get some runners on, but at this point there hasn't been many.
Waycaser at the plate, the right fielder. One out. Ball one. She looked tonight, she is 1-for-1 with an RBI, 13 on the year. She came in and had the base hit that scored Leonard in the second. The 1-0 in there, a called strike. 1-1 the count. You know, the Oklahoma State fans, you can start hearing them, the grumbles, what they're thinking, the zones in and out. But Oklahoma State fans are pretty knowledgeable. Oklahoma State's gotten 49-6 at home in the last 3 years.
They definitely have a home field advantage. I mean, just the whole atmosphere that comes with Oklahoma State. This has now been a program that Stillwater has embraced and gotten around.
1-2 the count. Pitch. Outside, 2-2. So you look at Maxwell trying to settle down here. Close the book here in the fourth. Waycaser steps out.
Umpire made sure to call time.
Pitch on the way, ground ball to third, foul. Count will stay at 2-2. A little something weird going on right there.
Yeah, I was wondering, I mean, if I was a pitcher, I'd probably know, but I was thinking, oh, was that motion towards pitching that stopped? That should have been a call? All of my pitchers out there that I know, I mean, maybe send me a text on that one. Let me know what was going on.
Maxwell delivers a 2-2. High for ball three. Starting to get into some of these long at bats.
Yeah.
A lot of pitches, full counts, giving up some walks.
Yeah.
Kind of stretching that pitch count out. Now it's 74. Just trying to see the bullpen.
Looks like we've got Lexi Kilfoyle warming up.
As that pitch is low and outside for ball four. That'll be a walk. The third walk of the inning.
You know, I don't normally say Kelly Maxwell's struggling, but I think in this game, she actually is. She's struggling, and Florida State doing a good job with their at-bats and making sure they don't swing at anything that's not a strike.
A little pause in the action as Coach Barfell comes out to have a little mound visit in the circle to talk it over. Basically, take a little break. She's at 75 pitches.
75 pitches.
Calm down. Middle infielders are talking. Everybody's kind of assessing the situation. With a lot of game left to play.
Yeah, and a three-game series, this is the time where, okay, if we don't come up with a win as Oklahoma State, we can go back and assess the situation and see where we need to go from here. I mean, there's still a lot of game left and still a lot of at-bats. But you can see Naomi's face right there. She kind of grimaced a little bit and was like, ooh. As a fielder, you know when your pitcher's on and when your pitcher's off, and you know when she's struggling, and this might be a time for the infielders to say, Kelly, we got you. Just pitch the ball. We got you.
They definitely have to lift her up, get ground balls. Let us help you.
Yeah.
Mudge, the leadoff batter, digs in. She's 0 for 2.
Well, that was just not very good technique for a slap. She was already running towards first base. If she had stayed straight towards the pitcher and thrown her hands to that lower pitch, she may have been able to beat that out after putting it in play.
With her speed, I mean, the big thing is just put the ball in play.
Exactly. You got to give yourself a chance. Put that ball in play. Put it on the ground. If it's in the air, you don't give yourself a good chance to.
Butt foul. Tuck. Chase makes the catch. What a play by Tuck. Get out of her stance, up against the fence, and makes the play for the second out.
Great awareness, too, of where that ball is going. You can see as soon as that ball is popped up, Taylor knows exactly where it's going. She gets a great jump on the ball. And in your home stadium, you know how far you can get. Ooh, that might have been trapped on the backstop there.
Kerr at the plate.
You know, that top of the lineup for Florida State, it hasn't produced as much runs, as many people on base as I was anticipating going into this game. It's been lower in the lineup, starting with Flaherty.
Kerr 0 for 2 with two strikeouts. Definitely expected the top of the lineup to be aggressive, to be hitting the ball, to be putting the ball in play, and that's not been the case. It's been the lower end pitch. Runner takes second. So Waycaser steals second base. It's the third stolen base of the day.
Let's take a look at the jump that Waycaser has at first base. She's going right with the pitch, takes a little bit of a peek to see where that ball is so she knows she can slide straight in.
A little bit of a delay, 1-1 the count. That ball fouled off down the first base line.
Kerr got that ball on the hands, well inside.
Great job just getting around on that ball.
Oh yeah. With all the equipment you use, you almost want to turn your shoulder a little bit and take one in the elbow.
So Waycaser, the runner at second in scoring position, pitch on the way. That's going to be a strikeout, throw out for the third out. And we'll look at the home run. The big three-run shot from Edenfield puts the Noles up 4-0 here in Stillwater. You're listening to Big 12 Now on ESPN.
You got to wonder, is she going to let her go to the distance tonight?
Well, with a 4-0 lead here in this game, I mean, you're talking bottom of four.
Yeah.
You're going to let it kind of ride and see if you even need to get into the bullpen.
Exactly. that gets into the gamesmanship, right? In this three-game series, how much do we hold back and don't show leading into that next game?
Edwards, a freshman left fielder, due up, 0 for 1. What a story. Graduates early, comes in, should be a senior in high school.
Yep.
Has become an everyday starter and left and worked her way to the number two spot in the lineup.
Oof.
It's in there for a called strike. Edwards, actually, when she broke into the lineup, was in the nine spot and then started hitting her way up the lineup, has now settled in to the second spot behind Becker.
Yeah, I guess when you can hit 407, Coach Gajewski said, that, you know what, let's put her at the towards the top of the lineup. And Coach G, some of the things he's done in the past is he's had his home run hitters right at the top spot. Naomi used to be the one, and he would say, I want to start that game off. If we can start it off with a home run, we're already putting so much pressure on the opposition. Why not? Why would we not do it?
It's all about production. Who's gonna hit? If you can hit, you can get in the lineup.
Exactly.
1-1 pitch. That ball's lined down the first base line, foul. So if you're Oklahoma State now, you're looking at a 4-0 deficit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Midway through the game. Mm-hmm. What do you got? What's your game plan? What's your adjustments?
You got to chip away a little bit at a time, and knowing every at bat and every pitch that you swing at counts. You've got to get a little bit patient, and you've got to understand the strike zone of the umpire. You got to know which pitches you hit well, and maybe even sit back and see if you're going to see one of those pitches. Knowing Sandercott's moving the ball in and out with the umpire calling it, you've got to be ready if you have two strikes on you to go ahead and swing at those pitches.
2-2 count. Look at Kenny Gajewski. Kenny, I mean, he's all about confidence. Get in there, find a ball you can see, find a ball you can hit, and drive it.
Yeah, get in there with a chip on your shoulder a little bit, right?
And he doesn't care what year you are.
No.
Freshman, senior, it's all about production.
Oh, yeah. Seniority goes to those who produce.
That ball popped up and out of play. 2-2. Count remains.
And there's still plenty of game, like I said. I mean, it's 4-0, but if you have the game plan of chipping away a little bit at a time, like, let's work on getting that first base runner. Let's work on moving her over. And then all you have to do is get a hit through the infield, and then you score. So it goes back to just those little fundamental things of breaking it down small.
Edwards digs in, 2-2 pitch. Swung on, missed. That'll be a strikeout. That's actually the first strikeout of the game.
Sandercott putting that ball on the knees inside and Talon taking a swing at it. And I'm sure she's thinking, you know, with that ball moving in and out and that umpire calling it, like, I have to swing at it.
The first strikeout of the game for Sandercott comes here in the fourth. Kylie Naomi's up. Oklahoma State starting to work through this lineup for the second time.
Yeah.
That'll change their approach, just knowing what they've been through. Ground ball, foul, third.
Yeah, I think if you're Oklahoma State, you've got to be ready going in. Okay, I'm thinking, in my mind, all right, I got to be ready early in the count. The deeper I go, the more those balls are going to be off the plate.
Still a lot of ground balls for Oklahoma State.
Yeah, Sandercott doing a good job of keeping the ball down.
1-1 count. Right now, you just feel like she's in control. She's settling in. She's hitting her spots.
Yeah.
She's doing everything she needs, and Oklahoma State really hasn't been able to catch a break at all.
As a pitcher, you've got a 4-0 lead, and you can breathe just a little bit more.
Ground ball to short. Muffley boots it, picks it up, fires to first, but not in time. As the hustle down the line, and Naomi beats it out. That's going to probably be a fielding error on the shortstop.
That's a tough look right there. We can't quite see, so let's take a look here. Ooh, it's so close.
We'll check the official ruling.
They're going to go to an umpire review, and unless there's irrefutable evidence, the play of out will stand.
So Muffley, who was right there,
yeah,
booted it right off the bat, collected the ball, made the throw to have a bang-bang play. We have not seen official ruling from the scorekeeper.
Let's see if we're going to slow this down a little bit, get a good look. There's that boot. She came up with the glove just a little bit early. That's a tough one right there. I'm not sure that I get a good look.
Bang, bang.
Bang, bang, yeah.
Be tough to overturn, and the longer it goes, the more likely the call on the field will stand.
Exactly.
Which, if in the Oklahoma State category, you're talking one out with a runner on.
Yeah.
And see if they can make something happen here.
You know, as a base runner, you've got to make sure you touch first base with the front part of your foot on the front part of the bag, too. So this comes down to a little bit of base running, which I think Naomi did a good job of. And she didn't give up the whole time, because it would be very easy for her to say, you know what, I go straight to the shortstop, one of the best players on the field, if not the best. Like, I'm just going to go ahead and slow up. But she went full bore, 100% all the way through.
That goes back to the relentless effort.
Relentless effort, that's true. That's
doesn't very matter true. The situation, mm-hmm. you're hustling down the first.
Mm-hmm.
Work is on deck, four-hole hitter. She actually reached on a throwing error her first time up. Oklahoma State, no runs, no hits, no errors right now on the board. So Sandercock has the no-hitter in the bottom of the fourth.
Ooh, you said it, didn't you? Did you do that on purpose?
No, I know we went through the Georgia Southern no-hitter.
Yeah.
And so it sets it up, which, I mean, isn't shocking the way Sandercock is working
right
through the lineup.
Right.
You look at the experience of Sandercock. I mean, she has, coming into this game, she had pitched 50 and two-thirds innings. The next closest pitcher for Florida State, Royalty at 29 and two-thirds.
Wow,
and the review is officially in. She's safe.
Wow.
So the call on the field stands. They officially called her safe at first, live, and then the review confirms that. And so with one out, Oklahoma State will have a runner at first in Kylie Naomi.
And Naomi does have some speed.
Technically, it does go down as an E6 fielding.
Gotcha.
And Wark steps in. It'll be a good time for Oklahoma State for the Big 12 hitter of the week to come up.
Yeah, say this is why I got the award right here.
Pitch is high.
Little off-speed action right there.
Naomi getting a good little break at first. Wark does have 20 RBIs. We've got some production coming up here in the lineup for Oklahoma State. One-oh pitch. Hit up the middle. That's a tough play. That'll be a single. Runners at first and second. Just out of reach of Muffley. And finds its way to center field.
Hey, those bloop hits sometimes work really well. It's not a run manufacturer normally, but it does the job. Little inside pitch. Wark didn't get her barrel on that ball. It goes off of her hands just a bit.
A little bit later in the season, that'll be a line drive up the middle.
Yeah, the more barrel you can get on that ball, the farther it's going to go.
Carwell up, now 0 for 1, the right fielder. Two runners on base, one out. The opportunity that Oklahoma State is looking for.
And this is one of those opportunities that hasn't come along, so they really have to be prepared to manufacture some runs. You don't want to leave these players on base.
It's a called strike. So that bloop single to center by Wark was the first hit for the Cowgirls today.
As a runner, you want to go ahead and take a look and see where your outfielders are. So if the ball goes in the outfield, you know exactly how much room you have.
A big swing and a miss behind in the count, 0-2. Now if you're Oklahoma State, a ball base hit to the outfield with Naomi at second.
Right.
You know, you've got a decision to make.
Exactly. Exactly. And that's where the trust in your coach comes. The coach says go, and you're Naomi rounding third base. You're going to go with everything you have.
And trying to pick your coach up early.
Yep.
0-2 pitch, fouled off.
And the outfield isn't too terribly deep, so that comes into play, too. If the ball is hit straight at an outfielder, you might want to hold up at third base. If they have to move left or right, that's going to give you the opportunity to score.
It's kind of, I was looking at the infield, the first and third at the bags.
Yep.
Middle infield up the middle for the double play. 0-2 pitch from Sandercock, outside, ball one.
Good hold up by Carwile, swinging at that rise ball just before. Now, if you're Sandercock, do you go back to your bread and butter for this game and work the ball in and out instead of going up in the rise ball?
I mean, I would think you go your drop ball, try to get your ground ball for your double play.
Yeah.
Carwile is hitting 357 with runners on. 1-2 pitch outside, 2-2. Some signals. Defense trying to make some adjustments here. Chess match. 2-2 count, one out. Runners at first and second. Florida State still up 4-0 here in the bottom of the fourth. Sandercock has been in control this whole time. Ground ball to first, foul.
Carwile, good job fighting off that inside pitch.
Sandercock left shaking her head. Yeah, got my ground ball.
Yeah.
Little foul, but that's
right.
What she's looking for. Get that ground ball, get the double play.
Right.
You do have speed at second. So on a base hit,
yep.
We'll see where the action goes. Two pitch, ground ball to first, at the bag, foul. They actually said it hit foul first, so dead ball, 2-2 count.
Gotcha. See if it clips Carwile on her foot. Yep, it does, right on the top of the ankle there. That's one of those you want to sell it, shake it real good so everybody knows, hey, that ball hit me.
You may not be faking it with Sandercock pitching.
Yeah, that's true, with her down and in pitch to the lefties.
Look in, 2-2. Oof. Inside, 3-2. You just feel the pressure, you feel the momentum, which is a beautiful part of the game.
Beautiful, beautiful. Gotta love that pressure.
These are the moments where you're looking for somebody to step up.
Yeah.
Get a hit, see if you can force the action. One out. Sandercock looks in, pitch on the way, foul.
Good battle right here. Who's gonna win it? Carwell doing a good job of fouling off those pitches. Taking it all in stride. She seems very confident and very keyed in. And then Sandercock, she seems very confident as well. And this is going to be, I mean, possibly a deciding factor on Oklahoma State scoring or not.
You have to take advantage of all opportunities.
Absolutely.
Especially in this game.
Absolutely.
3-2 pitch, inside, ball four, bases are loaded. A little drama.
Good battle, Carwile won that battle. And she's one of the Oklahoma State hitters this game that has been a little bit more patient and hasn't swung at those pitches that are down and in. And we've got a little conference coming with Coach Alameda.
You have Cheyenne Factor due up.
She's a clutch hitter. She enjoys that pressure.
Talk about pressure. If you go back to the 2019 World Series, or it's the Super Regional down in Tallahassee, Sandercock was a freshman and actually pitched in that game. Factor was in the lineup. During that game, Oklahoma State had three hits on the day. Factor had two of them, with a 3-2 win for Oklahoma State to advance them to the World Series. So Factor has been in big clutch situations her whole career. But in one of those moments in the Super Regional, right here, the same matchup.
The same matchup. Both a little bit more mature. Both having worked a little bit on their swing, and Sandercott on developing a rise and a change.
Bases loaded. Factor 0-for-1 with a fielder's choice.
Factor a little bit off the plate, possibly expecting or baiting an inside pitch or an outside pitch. I mean, there's that outside pitch.
One ball, no strikes. Factor hitting 500 with the runners in scoring position. Start hearing the social and the crowd really starting to get into it here. Now's the time. One ball, no strikes. Pitch on the way, fouled off.
This is where the home field advantage can come in. The fans are behind you, the ones in the outfield, the ones behind the plate, and this place gets a little bit louder. As an outfielder, you have to learn to deal with the heckling out there and just all the chatter, and know that you've got to stay in your zone and read that ball off the bat.
1-1 pitch. High, 2-1. I guarantee the social, the outlook, they're being friendly.
Oh, you know,
welcome to Stillwater.
Oh, yeah. It's
get
Oklahoma.
Your cheese fries,
oh,
all
yeah.
That type of stuff.
The Oklahoma niceness, right?
Yeah, the hospitality is probably awesome.
In fact, they're doing a great job of being selective with her pitches that she swings at. There's nowhere to put her. You have to pitch to her.
Ball fouled off, 2-2.
This is where Sandercock needs to allow her defense to play for her. Go ahead and pitch to Cheyenne Factor. Can't put her anywhere else, but make sure you give her something that's dropping off the table so she rolls over it.
A senior who's been in this situation steps in with confidence. A lot of pressure. 2-2 pitch coming up from Sandercock. Inside ball three.
Sandercock wanted that real bad, and she's probably thinking, I've gotten those pitches before. Little disappointment there.
Little inside, maybe a little high.
Maybe a little inside, a little high. I mean, that's what the umpire thought. I mean, that's where when you're a hitter and you're a pitcher, you're counting on your umpire to stay consistent.
And a full count with bases loaded. She looks in the pitch. That ball is a base hit to right. That'll score one. And they're going to hold work up at third. That'll be an RBI single from the senior, Cheyenne Factor. It's 4-1. Runners advance, still bases loaded, one out.
Cheyenne Factor letting that ball get a little bit deep, able to drive it through the infield. Waycaser throwing home. It was not cut off to prevent the ball from going to a backstop. If you've got a runner holding up at third base and you're the cut, you want to cut that ball. But you have to listen to your leader out there, your catcher. If she doesn't say cut, then you got to let the ball go through. But anytime you let that ball go through and there's not a play at the plate, you run the risk of the throw getting away.
That'll bring up Morgan Wynn. First pitch called strike.
You got to be ready early in the count on this one. That might be the best pitch you're going to see before Sandercock moves the ball a little bit in and out.
18 RBIs from Wynn. Bases loaded still. So the Cowgirls are trying to chip away at this lead.
Pitch inside, 1-1. Wynn has been outstanding both with softball and in the classroom. She's done a great job.
She's somebody that's made an impact on it and off the field. That excellence, the cowgirl way.
Third on the team in RBIs. Does have power of 4 home runs. Yes! That 1-1 pitch is inside, 2-1.
And those pitches from Sandercott are very close to being strikes. Extremely close. Was a good job laying off of that changeup off speed. But they're very close.
Wynn's played a lot of softball. She played a lot at Kansas prior to coming to Oklahoma State. 2-1 pitch coming up. 2 balls, 1 strike with 1 out. Pitch on the way. Foul off. 2-2.
Looking for something up in the zone to drive out of the infield. If you're going to swing at that rise ball, though, you've got to be on plane with it. So let's see if Sandercott goes and climbs that ladder just a little bit more to have Wynn miss on that rise ball.
Critical on the hand placement.
Exactly.
2-2 pitch. That ball hit, foul. Foul territory, Mack Leonard over and out of play. Mack Leonard was over there. Good effort, good hustle.
Yeah. You've got to put yourself in a position. If you catch that ball, you've got to turn around and make a play at home plate. Anytime that ball is not in the field of play and you're a base runner, you're going to go ahead and tag. It looks like she was trying to prevent a catch and carry into the dugout.
Pressure mounts with a 2-2 pitch. That's a ground ball to the shortstop. Muffley bats it down, but a run will score. That'll be a base hit and an RBI, and bases are still loaded.
Muffley doing a good job of keeping that ball in the infield. If she lets that go to the outfield, Oklahoma State possibly scores 2 instead of 1. And Muffley was playing well up the middle there.
Well, doing everything she can to come back and just bat that ball down.
Yeah.
And a heads-up play. Tugs at the plate. She grounded to first her last time up. The second time through, Oklahoma State starting to put the ball in play.
We saw this with Missouri. It took them 4 innings to go ahead and kind of get in their groove offensively.
This inning alone, they've had three singles, 2 runs, 3 hits.
Chipping away a little bit at a time.
That pitch inside.
Tanner Cross has been going inside to the lefties. That down and in pitch has been swung at several times. Tuck going ahead and holding up on that one just a little bit too inside.
First and third at the bags, which has allowed a couple of balls to get by. A pitch swung on and missed. 1-1 the count. 70 pitches now for Sandercock. And at this point, not really much of an issue pitch count wise. And she's settling in. It's still has a 2-run lead. Oklahoma State's all about getting back as many as you can. And they're in a good spot with bases loaded and 1 out. Pitch on the way, low, 2-1.
This is when you want your run manufacturers at the home plate.
You're at the bottom of the order, Tuck and Bloodworth, but then you can roll it over to Becker. And see if you can get that lineup back to the top.
Exactly.
Pitch, ground ball foul to first. 2-2. You have Carwell at third, Factor at second, Wynn at first.
Definitely speed at second and third.
center fielder playing deep.
And middle infield is definitely playing up the middle, expecting that ball to go up the middle.
Pitch on the way, ground ball to first. She'll throw it home for the force. Back to first, not in time, but the ball's thrown away and the run will score from third. So the runner will be safe at first on the fielder's choice. The run will score on the error.
Matt Glenner doing a good job coming up with that ball quickly, but then Edenfield doesn't quite throw the ball in a place where Edenfield can catch it easily, scoring two for Oklahoma State.
So with Factor, she comes in to score on the throwing error, and then Wynn quickly goes from second to third. So just a heads up play.
Good base running all the way around.
So it looks like we may have a pitching change here for Florida State. They're gonna replace the two-time All-American as we're in a 4-3 ball game now. Two outs, 31 Reed. McKenna Reed now pitching for Florida State. This will only be her
third pitcher for Florida State. She does have some velocity. She's got a rise of curve. And I've heard that she has a fantastic rise ball. She hit the weight room in the off season, building up her muscles, increasing her speed, working on some mechanical issues.
Bloodworth at the plate for Oklahoma State.
She does like to work the curveball in the hands of the right-handed hitters.
Oof, a little too close. Hits the hands of Bloodworth, and that's going to be bases loaded as Bloodworth takes over at first. Tuck will go to second.
Working on those hands, you gotta make sure you don't bring it too far in.
Oklahoma State, from a lineup standpoint, you were trying to roll it over, trying to get back to Becker, who has the 18-game hitting streak, and that's exactly what's happened. Tuck has done a great job of putting the ball in play. Bloodworth wears it. His base is loaded with two outs. We had some adjustments with the cards and the...
Yeah, each pitcher has their different call card. They have different pitches and different sequences. Got to make sure everybody's on the same page.
So Becker up, Edwards on deck, two outs. Becker still trying to find something she can drive. She has two ground outs today. Pitch outside, ball one.
And this goes back to almost a leadoff hitter situation in that this is a new pitcher. The only one that's seen it was hit by first pitch. So you do want to be aggressive and you do want to find something to drive, but at the same time, you have to be a little bit more patient and see what Reed is throwing. Everything up in the zone so far.
Outside ball two, only the 12th appearance of the season for Reed. She is 5-0 with a 1.25 ERA. So she's done well. Behind in the count to Becker, 2-0. That pitch, 3-0. No place to put her. Bases loaded.
Gotta let your defense play behind you. I know she's trying to draw that swing from Becker, but she's held up on that rise ball three times now.
She has not allowed an earned run in her last five appearances for Reed. It's a 3-0 count on the leadoff batter, Becker, right here. Inside ball four, that's a run. This game's tied. And Becker has now reached safely in every game that she's been a Cowgirl.
Very impressive.
It's a big RBI with bases loaded to draw the walk.
Becker inches closer to that longest hitting streak behind Taylor Lynch.
So that's extends the on-base streak to 20 for Becker. Wynn scored on the play.
Ooh. That's a called strike. Edwards wanted that one, jumping up and down like, ooh, that was the one I wanted to swing at. But I think that's kind of the right way to go when you have somebody in front of you who's walked on four straight pitches. You want to be just a little bit more patient.
The 0-1 pitch. Inside, 1-1.
When you're a runner at second base, you can go ahead and have that large leadoff. They're not so worried about you getting that leadoff. They're worried about that runner on third base. So in order to be able to score on a ball that's hit in the outfield, you have to take that large lead.
1-1 pitch. Edwards takes ball two, 2-1. So Reed had a little hard time trying to find the strike zone here. Big situations for the freshman.
Yeah, this is where Oklahoma State figures out who they can count on later in the year.
It's a tough ball hit to third. Third baseman comes up with it, fires to first in time. And so that will end the inning, but not before Oklahoma
State out. So the momentum of the hitters of Oklahoma State can continue.
Harding due up. Third baseman just made a play to finish that inning for Florida State. She's 1-for-2 on the day. Has a single. That pitch is inside for ball one. Hitting 375. Three homers, 15 RBIs. At this point for Florida State, you felt like you were in control of the game, 4-0, and trying to get back.
Yeah, that's a frustrating inning for Florida State. I'm sure they felt like they were in the driver's seat just a little bit. But when you're playing number three in the nation, Oklahoma State, they're not number three for nothing.
Well, we talked about this. Anytime you're in a game of this magnitude, there's going to be ups and downs. There's going to be adversity. Things are going to happen. You just have to continue to respond. Ground ball to third, fire to first in time for the out.
Yeah, that's how you face that adversity. How do you come back? When you're down by four, Oklahoma State found a way to chip away.
Well, I think we're going to look at that all weekend. It's going to be that same situation.
The back and forth and back and forth, yeah.
Dak attacks at the plate. The DP. 0-for-2, but you feel like at any moment she could go off.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, when you're in that four spot, you're there to do a job. You're there to hit people in. So not only are you a big hitter, but you're somebody who makes contact well.
Outside, 1-0. If you're Kelly Maxwell, you feel like you got a fresh start.
Yeah, it's 0-0 ball game. Yeah.
I mean, at this point, you try to settle in, forget what happened in the first four.
Mm-hmm.
Let's get back and finish this thing up.
Right, right. Let's finish strong.
Two balls, no strikes. And what has got her in trouble this whole thing is the walks.
Yes, yeah. Let's see, count them up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 walks this game. That's very uncharacteristic. But we have seen I don't want to call it mechanical issues, but when she misses, like, she really misses.
2 balls, no strike. Take all the way. In there for a called strike, 2-1.
You know, at this point, you got to go back to, okay, what did we talk about leading up to the game? What's our game plan? Let's go back to that. And Coach Barfield, such a good pitch caller. You just have to trust him with what he's giving you and throw it tough, throw it competitively.
It's fouled off down the third base line. And Dak is just living for another pitch, just fighting that one off.
Right.
Right there in the four hole, 30 on deck. If you're Florida State, you feel like this is where you want. You have your heart of your lineup coming up, so you feel like you're in a good spot here in the fifth.
Yeah, the ones in your lineup that are been producing. That's almost where you're starting off with. Little frustration there, not getting the call.
You've noticed the frustration on both pitchers.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
Not that you want to show up the home umpire, right. But both pitchers have been really frustrated with some calls tonight.
Right, right. And I know Oklahoma State fans are saying, we want those corners just like Sandercock was getting them. We want those corners too.
Full count here with one out. Maxwell pitch. Fouled off. And you know, all you're really looking for is consistency.
Right, right, right. Yeah.
I mean, you want to establish the zone from a pitcher standpoint, from a hitter standpoint.
Right, right.
At what point from a hitter do you just worry about finding a ball you can hit hard and get after
it? I mean, it depends on what kind of a hitter you are. If you're somebody that just reacts to the ball, you're just looking for a ball that you can hit. If you're somebody that's thinking through situations and trying to guess, those are the ones that you're going to play those games with just a little bit more. Lead off walk.
That's a walk to Dak. So that's a sixth walk of the game. So you got a runner at first, still one out. Again, you have a great middle infield.
Yep.
Maybe one of the best middle infields in the country with Kylie Naomi and Becker. So right now you're probably looking for the ground ball.
Yeah, you're looking to turn two if you can.
Big swing and a miss from Flaherty.
Take that energy out of the Noles offense. Get the first runner on by a walk, but if you can come up with a double play, all of a sudden there's a deflation that happens on the offensive side.
Flaherty has walked twice. No balls, one strike. Pitch high, 1-1.
Falling out of the box is Flaherty just a little bit. Looks like Maxwell scared her just for a minute there.
All smiles.
Yeah, and she just has the chin guard there. She doesn't have, like Oklahoma State has, the cage that goes around your face. So anything up in the zone close to your face, I'm sure, is a little bit of a scare.
1-1 pitch. 2-1. A little off balance.
Right, yeah.
Not really looking at the speed of Dak here. You know, you're going to have some opportunities to do something defensively.
I was wondering if they were going to put in a pinch runner.
This late, that's a real thing. 3-1 count.
Yeah. Maybe they're wondering, you know, what Flaherty's going to do. If they get two people on, maybe they'll throw in somebody to pinch run for Dak.
Especially if she gets a run in scoring position at second.
Yeah. Or maybe they're just confident in knowing that she gets good jumps.
Well, we know they're smart. I mean, they're really aggressive and smart on the bases. That 3-1 pitch fouled off. I thought that was a great swing by Flaherty, going at it, aggressive.
Oh, she was definitely aggressive. She threw everything she had at that pitch. Another 3-2 count. Getting towards 100 pitches for this game.
Full count pitch on the way, ground ball up the middle. Becker will pick it up and go to first. Dak gets to second, but two outs, and that's really all she had play-wise.
Yeah, yeah. Dak had already passed the Becker at second base, and Becker was coming in for that ball. If it had been a closer play, Becker may have had contact with Dak, but she wasn't even close.
So two outs, Mac Leonard up. Two walks today. Low for ball one. Again, Dak at second, still no runner. It's all her all the way.
You know, Kelly Maxwell has kind of been pegged as a strikeout queen, and I think she only has one strikeout this game and quite a few walks.
1-1, that pitch on the outside corner.
1-2-3 strikeouts.
So she came in having 77 strikeouts this season. I've got four.
You have four, okay.
Five strikeouts in this game. 1-1 count here with two outs. So five, simple math. You can just add it up. Oof. Two and one the count. Jump around here. Leonard plays first base for the Noles. Scored a run today, two walks. Maxwell trying to get the third out. Called strike. It's been given that pitch.
Does have some heat, and I've heard it's extreme velocity, but she has to find the strike zone.
Came in last inning. Took a couple batters to settle her down, but ended up getting the ground ball to get out of the inning. Kylie Naomi will lead off. Shortstop. First pitch, strike.
At this point in the game, we just need some consistency from the hitters. Consistency with swinging at the strike zone on both sides. Consistency in the circle. Got to let your defense play at this point.
That pitch high and inside, one and one.
If you're going to give yourself a chance as a pitcher, you have to make the pitch believable. Those ones that are up and in, they're just not believable.
Kylie Naomi, a three-time All-Big 12 selection. Career leader in double plays, 49. Pitch inside, two and one. We talked about that double play combination, but she has been a mainstay here. 223 career starts at shortstop.
I think she started every single time. I mean, so who was there? Sydney Pennington was there at shortstop. And when Naomi came in, Coach Gajewski moved Sydney Pennington to third base and said, Naomi, you've got that spot. She's had it locked down.
Big swing and a miss, 2-2 count. Not only has she locked it down, but, I mean, she's all through the record books. I mean, you start going through there and figuring out the best of all time to play here.
Yeah.
And she's in the record books.
Yeah. I'm wondering if there's going to be little asterisks here and there, like COVID senior has the record for
that 2-2 pitch fouled off. I think that's a great comment because when you are the all-time hit queen in college softball. I'm just saying, when you have over 400 hits and people are getting 6 years to do it now,
right?
You probably want the asterisk.
Yeah.
Which makes sense. I mean, and I always go back to, you know, the great records that never fall, even though guys, gals play a million more games.
Yeah.
That 2-2 pitch is fouled off, foul territory. Mac Leonard over there tries to make a play.
Looks like we've had a change at first base.
Defensively, first baseman now looks to be Keene. Bethany Keene, the senior from Bradenton, Florida, transfer from South Florida, has taken over at first for Mac Leonard. Well, Keene, great effort trying to get over that ball. 2-2 pitch. That ball's fouled off. Great at bat for Naomi. And look at the crowd. Bundled up, but here.
Bundled up in here, and everybody's in it to win it. The community has surrounded Oklahoma State and this Cowgirl softball team. Coach Gajewski has made something that he wants everybody to buy into. Rep, relentless excellence and passion. He wants everybody to buy into that. It's not just his, but he wants to give it away.
It's something every lady on this roster lives, and it's about all of Cowgirl softball. 2-2 pitch fouled off. You take that approach every day, every practice.
Right.
And then when they graduate, they're going to take it with them every day to work.
Exactly. Who doesn't want that in their company?
Reed trying to settle in here, the 2-2. Kylie Naomi proving not to be an easy out. Pitch on the way inside. 3-2, a full count.
That's an up in pitch that's not believable. It hasn't been swung at yet.
You see the senior shortstop, Muffley, kind of came up and had a few words. Great job to try to calm down the freshman here. Full count pitch. That ball's fouled off.
Yeah, this is a big time matchup for a freshman. You come into a program like Florida State, who's in the top 10 in the United States, and then you face somebody that's, when you look at national rankings, is supposed to be better than you, and you're facing hitters that are, you know, fifth, sixth-year seniors. It's a big-time matchup for her.
This is why she plays the game. This is why she went to college at Florida State, is to be in these moments.
Right. She wants those challenges.
We have the same situation in Oklahoma State where, you know, girls are coming to Oklahoma State to play in the World Series now, playing in big-time situations. That 3-2 pitch fouled off again.
Good battle by Naomi.
We talk about both these teams being hot. Again, Florida State came into this game, this series, on an 11-game winning streak. Oklahoma State, hey, we'll take 16 straight.
So somebody today, their winning streak will be broken.
But all those games, and you look at all of it, it's all in prep for conference play
right. And
NCAA postseason.
Exactly.
That's why you play these type of games.
Exactly. If you don't see good games before conference and into conference, that postseason is just not going to have that same feeling.
3-2 pitch fouled away.
You have to learn to struggle through the adversity. And if you don't have that struggle, how are you going to be the one in postseason that figures it out? If you haven't learned it up until then, you're not going to learn it.
You look at grow opportunities.
Grow opportunities, yes.
And, you know, we had an opportunity to talk to Coach Alameda about her grow opportunity last year in the Super Regional. And now you go back into and evaluate
right. And
get your team to stay focused, because you're going to have that situation come again.
Right, right.
And, you know, you look at their schedule, they're going to have a ton of ranked games coming up. Oklahoma State's going to turn around and play a tough Big 12 schedule. And you have OU front and center, Texas front and center. That pitch, 3-2 pitch line down the left field line. That'll be a base hit. What an at-bat by Naomi. That'll be a double right out of the box she was looking to.
She sure was. As soon as she saw that ball was going down the line and Mudge was nowhere near it, she knew she was going to make that turn and head to second base. So you can see she makes that. And as soon as she sees it goes down the line, she puts her head down, heads to first base, and is able to make that turn.
Look at that.
She dropped her shoulder just enough to get almost straight to second base. Little bit of an arc.
Trying to fire up that dugout here with no outs in the bottom of the fifth. Wark singled her last time up to center.
You know, anytime those dugouts are getting loud, the energy is up. Big swing.
The 1-for-2, still hitting .467. She wanted that last pitch going after it.
Yeah, she did. She saw that up pitch and was like, I'm going to take that yard.
Still no win here at the ballpark, and there it is again.
Same one.
That's a challenge from a pitcher, back-to-back going up.
Oh, yeah. Let's see if you can catch up to this one, and you can't.
Heading the count 0-2. Reed 5-9 out of Portland, Oregon. 0-2 pitch.
Challenging her again on that rise ball. Work was able to hold up that time and said, I need something a little bit farther down in the zone.
Discipline check.
Yeah. Swung at it twice. I'm not going to swing at it a third time.
Runner in scoring position at second is Naomi. Good speed. She's already scored once today. 1-2 pitch. That'll be a strikeout.
Held up on the third one, was not able to hold up with that fourth pitch up in the zone. Re-challenged Wark the whole time up in the zone. And you can see that ball just jump straight over Work's bat.
Carwile up now for Oklahoma State. We'll have a little conference in the circle. Now you wonder how much the, from a technology standpoint and watching games, how much they had dialed in on that, because she immediately was going up and in.
She sure was. And I think as the game goes on, Lonnie Alameda is the pitch caller. She gets a feel for the matchups that are coming and what needs to happen.
For Florida State, Royalty is actually warming up. Allison Royalty, a lot of options here. Full pitching staff for Lonnie Alameda. And Florida State's going to look at all options because they want to win this game.
Yeah, they didn't come all the way to Stillwater to lose, that's for sure. They were going to bring their best A game.
And they have a tough series. They got three here, and then they got one at OU on Tuesday.
Yeah, turn around and let's go play number one. We played number three. Hey, while we're here, let's just go play number one.
So I'm excited. Each game, we're going to have its own dynamics going on. And tonight, right here in the bottom of the fifth, it's a 4-4 game. Carwile's at the plate. It's a called strike. Michelle Smith was very complimentary of Coach Alameda's pitch call.
Yeah, I was listening to a game that Michelle Smith did earlier this year with Florida State, and she just was so complimentary of how Coach Alameda calls the game.
Muffley tries to make the play at third, throws it away, and a run will score on the throwing error. Carwile reaches first and advances to second on the error.
Let's see where that throw ended up for Muffley. Got Hartley playing third base. That ball was just a little bit too close to the runner, a little bit down. Third baseman wasn't able to come up with it.
Harding just could not make the play. He was trying to make the catch. The ball wasn't thrown that badly, to be honest with you, but she could not make the catch. Gets away, allows the run to score. And then you have the runner smart enough to get to second. So a heads up play, and you have a runner in scoring position. You're now up 5-4 with one out.
And with speed on second base, Florida State has to be very careful with the ball placement, the pitches to Factor, who was very patient last time up to bat.
So Carwell officially reaches on the fielder's choice. Naomi advances to third and then scores on the throwing error. Factors up. That's a ground ball back to the middle. Reed picks it up, fires to first. Two outs on the board, but Carwell was able to advance to third. 60 feet.
Yeah, makes a big difference, doesn't it?
So 60 feet is something Lonnie Alameda was talking about, how critical in close games 60 feet is and how important they take speed, their approach, everything. That's such a big factor in the game. She is making her calls. Morgan Wynn at the plate, the DP. 5-4 ball game, Oklahoma State with the lead.
And the last couple times up, Wynn has taken that first pitch straight down the middle of the plate. If I'm a hitting coach, I would say, okay, this is what we did last time. She might be bringing it down the middle of the plate the next time. Be ready.
Swing it. No balls, one strike. Pitch on the way. Swing and a miss, 0-2. Wynn does have a single. She does have an RBI and a run scored. And that second at bat, obviously this is a different pitcher, so everybody's facing Reed for the first time. But the idea is being aggressive and taking advantage of the strikes. 0-2 pitch, fouled off.
And now being down 0-2, Wynn has to battle. You can't afford to not swing at a pitch that just isn't quite good enough.
Just heard the baseball one. The 0-2 pitch fouled off.
When swinging under that just a little bit, she dropped her hands instead of swinging straight through that ball.
staying alive and being aggressive, competing.
Competing, yes. From both sides, Reed and Wynn.
Carwell third, looking in. 0-2 pitch. Outside. Reed walking it off.
That was a pretty close one to let go by. But the umpire agreed with Wynn that that was two outside.
Three or four pitches now, or the pitchers have literally walked out of the circle thinking it was over.
Yeah. Thinking it was almost automatic. Like, why didn't you call that ball a strike? Everybody thought it was a strike but you.
One ball, two strikes. Foul ball.
But you're right. You don't want to show up an umpire. You need to wait until he makes his call before you're heading back into the dugout.
When you have national contenders like this who understand the magnitude, been in the moments, so they expect those calls.
And we definitely expected it.
One ball, two strikes, two outs. And pitch on the way. Morgan Wynn drives that ball up the middle. Muffley with the adjustment, throws it out at first, and that will end the inning. But Oklahoma State picks up a run and takes a 5-4 lead heading to the sixth. And they expect big things from her during her career. Keep coming in here and having aggressive at-bats and powerful, doing work in the weight room. I know that was a big thing in the offseason.
Yeah. She's been stable behind the plate, catching almost every single game. She's somebody that Florida State looks to be a leader back there.
19 RBIs. Maxwell still in the circle for the Cowgirls. She's kind of a bulldog. She's just going at it. Great game. She doesn't want out of it. She's in it. She's ready to compete.
Very workmanlike.
Two balls, no strikes. So the bottom half of the lineup due up for Florida State. Enfield, Muffley, and then Waycaster. Waycaster is now on right. That pitch outside, 3-0. Still been action in the Oklahoma State bullpen. That's kind of been the case for the last couple innings. Really for both sides.
Yeah, from both sides. And Oklahoma State, I think if they get down a little bit, and you know, Maxwell's just having a hard time. She's had quite a few leadoff walks. Just really uncharacteristic. She's usually a pitcher that gets on top quickly. So getting behind 3-0, not for the first time either.
So you look at that 3-0 pitch in there for a called strike. Clearly another take situation.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I wouldn't have given the green light when, when you're in field and you can hit it over the...
A mile?
Over the flag, over the lights. But 3-1 count. I don't think in this day and age very many people get the green light on 3-0.
I think you're right.
3-1 pitch, outside ball four. This sets up a leadoff walk. And Muffley, the shortstop, coming up. And before we get to her at bat, let's talk about the shift that she had defensively in that last inning for Florida State.
She was playing way up the middle and made it look easy just fielding the ball behind second base.
They had
Morgan, throw to first.
They had Morgan Wynn basically mapped out and scouted perfectly.
Yep.
And she was over there making a play. Looks like they're going to have a pinch runner at first as Ross comes in to pinch run for Edenfield. And at this point here in the sixth, that's a tying run.
Yeah. It's good to save the knees of your catcher, give her a little bit of a break. Put somebody in that maybe has a little bit more speed on the bases. Want to make something happen.
Maxwell having a hard time finding the zone. That pitch outside for ball one. Coach Alameda said that Ross would be one of the first ones out of the dugout on the bases just because of how smart she is.
Right.
Pitch on the way, runner on the move, throw down a second. Not in time as Ross gets under the tag.
Florida State pressing the issue of, we want to get somebody in scoring position. You saw Muffley showed bunt, took it back to try and get the bat in Taylor Tuck's line of vision, and it does look like that Ross is safe. Yeah, before the tag is applied, her foot is on the bag.
Bang, bang. Nice slide by Ross.
Yes.
1-1 count now.
When you can tuck that right leg and get it away from the tagging infielder, that gives you that much more of a chance to touch the bag with your right foot.
Muffley had squared to bunt in that situation, pulled it back because she thought it was outside, and it was actually called strike on the outside corner. Four stolen bases in this game for Florida State.
Aggressive on the base pass is what we thought we'd see.
Ground ball to third. Bloodworth fires to first.
Oh.
In time. Work dropped it, picks it up for the out, but Ross advances to third.
So Bloodworth making that play, looking back to second, throwing one. Work picked it up like, well, yeah, she's out.
The first baseman, just nothing to see here.
Nothing to see here.
It's pretty easy. I got it.
Made the play. No problem.
So the 5-3 put out, but the tying run now sits at third base with one out.
Yeah. And Bloodworth did the right thing by checking the runner before she threw, but the threw a lot of pitches this game, too. When you go 3-0 on batters, you tend to throw a little bit more pitches.
Waycaser at the plate. Outfielder, 1-for-1 on the day with a single, walk and an RBI. Kilfoyle trying to battle. Help her team get the win in this first game. One-oh pitch. Ball two.
And the Noles are going to have to be a little bit patient, especially with those drop balls from Kilfoyle. They're either going to have to take it for a ball or get their hands down at the zone for contact.
Kilfoyle throws the ball hard, but also has a good off-speed pitch.
She does. That's where she's going to keep those hitters off balance.
2-0 pitch fouled off, 2-1. This is not a moment that she's not used to.
Being, true.
You know, playing in Alabama and being in the SEC and having opportunities, but, you know, usually she's in a starting role.
Right.
Working her way into situations. Coming in a relief here, this is about winning the game.
This is definitely about preserving that lead that Oklahoma State has. Getting Oklahoma State back in the dugout for offense.
2-1 pitch high. One out. Infield drawn in.
They're ready to cut that ball off. So with drop ball pitchers, you do tend to have more ground balls because it's farther down in the zone.
3-1 pitch coming up with one out. Ball four.
First and third situation here. What does Florida State do? Do they keep the runner on first and see if they can push that run in from third base? Or do they force the issue and send the runner to second base, hoping for a throw down?
Well, we're going to have a little
powwow.
A little conference here for the Noles. Talk about it. Situation. Obviously, they've had a couple stolen bases. They're going to try to get out of the double play situation. But you're back up to the top of the order with Mudge.
Right.
So when you have a dynamic player like Mudge, you're looking to her to make something happen.
She's definitely been a playmaker before this game. I mean, she's had a strikeout, a ground ball, pop. I wonder if maybe you go back to the bunt and force the issue with the defense.
She is hitting .361, 16 RBIs. See if the infield stays drawn in. I'm surprised they're not dropping back up the middle to get the double play.
It looks like possibly Rachel Becker will be covering second base.
Outfielder shifting to the left a little bit. Pitch on the outside corner for a called strike. You see Factor and Edwards.
Moving towards that left field side. Big gap there between center and right field.
Just look at the scouting reports. You look at all these games and you're watching games and you're putting reports together and you're using technology to help in these shifts.
Much going back to the slap. Trying to force the issue, putting the ball in play on the ground.
1-1 is the count.
I always loved drop ball pitchers when I was a slapper because it's easier to throw your bat at it, pound it into the ground, and just run. So if Mudge can run straight and keep her body facing the pitcher with her hands back, it's going to be more successful. There goes the runner.
So they're going to give up the stolen base to get the runner at second. So that takes the double play out of play there.
Right.
Two balls, one strike. Obviously, even if you made a play, the shortstop, second baseman's going to have to cut it off because of the speed of Ross.
Yeah, and Tuck threw it straight back to the pitcher quickly, maybe thinking Ross would make a play for home or Muffley.
2-1 pitch, fouled off, 2-2.
Got under that ball just a little bit.
You know, one thing about slappers, I always wonder, as you're moving forward in the box, your head's moving too. So, I mean, how difficult is that? The ball's already rising on you, your head's moving, you're trying to get on top. There's so much going on.
Yeah. Well, you try to keep your upper body and your head still and let your lower body do the work.
2-2 pitch from Kilfoyle. Fouled off. Watch Ross at third. When that pitch is coming in, she's floating with it. That ball hits the dirt, she's gone.
Yep. So it's almost like a safety squeeze, right? See the ball on the ground and then run.
I'm just watching her float down the third base line. Again, it's a heck of a ball game, 5-4. Cowgirls lead in Stillwater here in the top of the sixth. 2-2 pitch, ground ball to first, and that'll be a fair ball. The run will score at home.
Mudge stopped halfway down first base line.
Mudge thought it was a foul ball.
Yeah.
It was fair, called fair by the home umpire.
Ross scored easily on that. So Mudge putting the ball in play. And you can see that's exactly where she stopped, and I'm wondering if she was either trying to avoid a tag or thinking the ball was foul.
Well, I'm not sure that Work shouldn't have let that ball go.
Yeah.
And it was heading foul.
Right.
I would have stayed away from it and see if it was going foul, because if you go back and look at it, it was heading that direction when
field
she
awareness.
Picked it up.
Yeah, field awareness and being smart, knowing the game.
Because now she picks it up, it's a fair ball.
And
Ross was going to score anyway based off her speed and the way she was playing at third.
Yeah, so if you let that ball travel a little bit more, hey, it goes foul, everybody goes back. It goes fair, you get an out at one at least. So I'm sure Coach Gajewski is like, I think that ball was foul. Are they going to go to a replay and see?
I think the batter much thought it was foul.
Yeah.
Because obviously she stopped.
She stopped.
But, you know, did she stop to avoid the tag?
Right.
It's hard to say, but look at watch the trajectory of the ball. It looks like it's going to go foul.
Yeah, so let's take a look at Work and where she is. So she starts to come towards the bag. Yeah, I think that ball would have gone foul.
I think you leave that ball alone.
Yeah.
Obviously, she makes the play.
Right.
Ross had too much speed coming from third, so the game's tied 5-5.
Well, maybe Work thought she caught the ball in foul territory.
A lot of discussion going on. Kenny obviously is having an open discussion.
I'm sure he's having an open discussion. Absolutely.
You know, you have a runner at first in Mudge. Ross scored.
Mm-hmm.
Waycaser moves to third. So now it's runners at the corners with one out.
So it looks like umpire and first base coach are having a discussion there on, well, what do you think happened? I don't know. What do you think happened?
This is a time where you get to ad lib.
Right.
You know, you can, whatever you want to say, they're going to say.
Yeah.
Kenny's getting all of his money's worth, though, whatever it is.
Oh, yeah. It would have been bad lip reading, like NFL.
Yeah, there you go.
We could have done that.
A 5-5 ball game here in the top of the sixth. Kilfoyle is now the pitcher. Transfer from Alabama. Came on in relief of the starter, Maxwell. The Florida State coach is talking it over. Runners at the corners. You can't help but having a runner at first. Yeah, they called her safe.
Call stands.
Well, what a tricky situation. And I didn't see the home plate umpire jump out foul.
No.
He didn't raise his hands. He didn't do anything behind
home plate.
It was live ball.
Yeah.
But it's weird that the runner would stop. There was a lot of different stuff going on
mm-hmm.
that play.
Mm-hmm.
Janai Kerr, center fielder at the plate. She's 0 for 3 with 3 strikeouts. The official ruling on Mudge would be a fielder's choice RBI. Belvai is going to pinch hit. We're going to have a pinch hitter here in the number 2 spot.
Yeah, with Kerr having 3 straight strikeouts, I'm sure you're going to try to put somebody in there that can do something.
Belvai, the sophomore, comes out swinging.
Yeah, aggressive with that first pitch. She said, I'm hungry. If I'm going to get in, I'm going to put in my work. Takes a deep breath before stepping in that box. And those deep breaths sometimes in this big situation just calms you just enough to be focused.
Runner still in on the infield for the Cowgirls. One out.
We'll have to see what the call is for first and third. Florida State sends the runner. Holds the runner at first base. Tries to draw the throw down to second base by sauntering down to second. There's quite a few different plays that could happen.
Belvai aggressive at the plate. I'm all about that.
Hey, I love that too. Somebody that's going to get in there and put in the work.
5-5 game.
And then we'll see if a drop ball by Kilfoyle will put Belvai.
It's a ground ball up the middle. Kilfoyle has it. She runs the runner back to third. Throw to third. In time. The tag is made. And they're going to try to double up. As Mudge is able to get to third on the play. Looks like she's hurt. They're going to take a minute.
Yeah,
looks like maybe
in.
She lost her air.
So you see the runner at third as soon as the ball is put in play. She's taking off. But we see Kilfoyle running her back to third base smartly instead of running her back to home plate. As we got the runner at second already thinking, it's going to be a rundown. I got to get to third base. Ooh, you can see that left arm just got maybe jammed a little bit.
You know, a tough tag for Bloodworth right
uh-huh.
there. I mean, that ball
she
from Kilfoyle was way high.
Yep.
Still got it down, made the tag, and then the heads-up play to try to get the rundown for Mudge. Now, again, the aggressive base running. Belvai gets to second, Mudge to third. Two outs now. Still a 5-5 game. That pitch to Harding in there for a called strike.
Just tickled that outside corner just enough.
The extra bases impressed me for Florida State. Every time, you know it's a stolen base, you know they're going to take that extra base.
Yeah.
No balls, one strike, Kilfoyle, pitch outside, 1-1.
You know it's hard as a base runner at third base if your goal is to score and your coach has said, you know what, when that ball's in play, you go. The hard part is when it goes right back to the pitcher. You have to freeze immediately.
I thought Kilfoyle did a nice job of running her back, and making her commit to third,
yes,
before making the throw.
Exactly. If you're going to want a bang-bang play, you want it at third base and not home.
The 1-1 pitch on the way, a big swing and a miss.
Little off-speed change on the outside part of the plate. Harding way out in front of that one.
She sprinkles that in there just enough
just
to
enough.
Keep them off balance.
Just enough.
I watched her do that against Virginia Tech.
Ooh.
In that Clearwater tournament.
Yeah.
She did that really well.
And it's not necessarily every batter and every at-bat. Like you said, it's just a sprinkle. It's not enough where people think it's coming for, you know, the third strike.
That 1-2 pitch, a ball, 2-2. They actually appealed down to third.
Crowd wanted that one real bad.
All the close calls just add to the drama.
The great action. That's where those little skills come in. Do you work on first and thirds and running players back? Those are things you have to work on. If you don't, you're not going to get it right.
2-2 pitch low. 3-2. Two outs. You're looking at Kilfoyle. Does she try to go back to the changeup here with the full count?
Let's see what she's going to do.
She has options. Harding 1-for-3 on the day. And here's a 3-2 pitch. That ball smoked to left. Over the left fielder's head and off the wall. That's going to pick up two RBIs and a long single. Great job by Factor getting that ball in and keeping Harding at first. But she does pick up the two RBIs.
And you saw she was thinking two out of the box. Got halfway down the first base to heading toward second base and went, oh, I better go back. When that ball is smoked to outfield and comes off the wall quickly, you can't do that. But yes, two RBIs.
So Kerr scores, Waycaser scores. So now 7-5, Florida State with two outs. And that ball was absolutely smoked.
Smoked. Hit the top of the wall there.
Edwards had no chance.
No chance.
That ball was line drive.
Yeah.
About 3 feet from going out.
Yeah. And Harding knew her limits. She went, okay, you know what? I'm going to go back for my long single. That's just fine.
And great job knowing the park to take that ball off the fence.
Yes.
To be able to get it in.
Yeah, knowing you don't have a play at any other base but second.
So one strike to Dak. Dak walked her last time up. So she's 0-for-2 with a strikeout, a ground out, and a walk. Harding single. Long shot off the wall. Breaks this game open. 7-5 now, Florida State.
The teams battling against each other, Oklahoma State making up the 4-0 deficit, going up by one. Florida State saying, that's not enough. We're going to come back and shove it in your face.
There's still two innings for Oklahoma State. Said we're not done. This is still not finished. This is a good game, 7-5. Dak ahead in the count, 2-1. Kilfoyle's pitch. The changeup in there for a called strike, 2-2. I didn't see the pitch Harding, but Harding was sitting.
Oh, she was waiting for it, yeah.
Jumped all over it.
Oh, yeah. She was right on plane, firing on all cylinders, loaded well. Got her hips through incredibly.
It's RBI 16 and 17 for Harding. 2-2 pitch outside, 3-2.
You know,
a lot of this all with two outs.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Now, I got to wonder, as a hitter facing Kilfoyle, her back arm swing is very slow and she doesn't cover it, so I'm wondering if they're picking up the seams of the ball and where she's grabbing them. Slowly back.
3-2 pitch popped up. Factor comes in, makes the play for the third out, but not before the big double picks up two RBIs, and Florida State takes a 7-5 lead heading to the bottom of the sixth. You're watching Big 12 Now on ESPN+.
Sometimes we lose, sometimes we win. Sometimes we try to fit it all in. Sometimes we don't know what's in store. Sometimes we find what we're looking for. Sometimes we're rolling easy and free. Sometimes one and one makes three. So much to love along this ride. That's why Nationwide is on your side.
BK Musa here, everyone say cheese. Classic bacon and spicy. Flame grilled double on a toasted bun with the caramelized onions, now I want one.
BK, have it your way.
Bye-bye cough.
Later chest congestion. Hello, 12 hours of relief.
12 hours? Not coughing? Hashtag still not coughing?
Mucinex DM gives you 12 hours of relief from chest congestion and any type of cough, day or night. Mucinex DM, it's comeback season.
This event gets better every year and buzzing with excitement right now.
We'll see if they can avoid the water.
No chance.
Oh, yes! He knocks it in.
A souvenir for a lucky fan.
Great to be with you throughout the day.
What a great environment. I just love tournament time.
Back to Stillwater. We're heading to the bottom of the sixth, and what a ball game. Florida State up 7-5. Edenfield, a big three-run homer in the fourth. Harding just hit the two-run single in the sixth. And Sandercock, who started this game, pitched 3 2/3, is now coming back in. And for the Cowgirls, all five runs unearned. Kylie Naomi has scored twice. Maxwell went 5 1/3 and was now replaced with Kilfoyle, who's pitching now. But what a game, back and forth.
It has definitely been a back and forth game. When you get to the bottom of
six
innings, I wouldn't have said the score would be 7-5 with Florida State being ahead. That's not what I would have guessed. And Florida State is proving me wrong. Sandercock going back in. Sounds like Lonnie Alameda said, you know what, let's get her to finish the game so we can move on.
So the two-time All-American has come back into the game.
And they could be playing the odds of bottom of the lineup. Let's see who did better. Was it Reed or Sandercock?
Lott. We're going to have a pinch hitter for Oklahoma State. Katie Lott, the freshman out of Cypress, Texas, is going to hit. Coach is really, really high on Lott.
She's done well in that pinch hit spot. She comes in gritty, she comes in hungry, and she puts in her work.
You know, I had the privilege to watch BP, and she was one of the gals that was in the box when I was down there, and she was listening to every little detail. She wanted to know. She was a sponge, taking it all in.
Yeah, she's been a clutch hitter. She and Coach Gassi says she could be the missing link for our team. I'm not sure exactly what that means. I'll have to follow that up.
Sandercock, first pitch, a strike. Always wondered about this. You pitch for 3-4 innings, take a break. Now you're back in.
Yeah.
And that's gotta be tough. But you mean a true champion.
She had to stay warm. You couldn't go back in the dugout, get cold, and re-warm up.
The 0-1 pitch, 1-1. And back in the day, pitchers, once they were done, they were probably at Joe's. You know, you're going to have to call
cheesy
me back.
Yeah.
Sandercock says, I got more innings. Let's close this thing out.
Let's do it. And she did have three great innings until Oklahoma State caught up.
1-1 pitch, ground ball up the middle. Sandercock grabs it, throws it to first, and fielding her position. We've seen her do that a couple of times today.
You gotta love a pitcher who can field her position.
Well, when you're used to getting a lot of ground balls,
yeah,
you better get used to it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you're in a very vulnerable position as a pitcher. You've pitched the ball. You're not exactly in a stance that you can get one that's coming at your shins, but those one hoppers back at you are a little bit easier.
So Bloodworth at the plate, the 9-hole. She was hit by a pitch her last time up.
That up and in pitch.
That ground ball up the middle, same show. Over to first for the second out.
All smiles by Sandercock.
And the last thing Oklahoma State wants is Sandercock to settle in and have confidence to start mowing batters down here late in the game.
Yeah. Oklahoma State needs to extend these offensive innings, and with two outs with bang-bang plays, it's just tough to start going.
Becker running out of time to extend that hitting streak. It's at 18 games. She's now up here in the bottom of the sixth. Oof. Ball one.
Coming
she
on
did,
the inside.
She did, however, extend her on base streak. So
with that walk.
That's at 20. But she's 0 for 2 today with a walk and an RBI. This will be her third at bat against Sandercock. The one walk came against Reed in the fourth. A 1-1 pitch, a 1-1 count right now. Florida State up 7-5. The Noles have 7 runs, 4 hits, 4 errors, which is shocking. The Cowgirls, 5 runs, 4 hits, no errors.
Yeah, usually if you have 4 errors, you don't expect to be ahead.
The 1-1 pitch inside, especially not a game of this magnitude.
Right.
I mean,
right.
Four errors in a game, and they've been able to survive in advance.
Mm-hmm. And I think it just goes back to those walks that Maxwell had.
Timely hitting.
And timely hitting, yes.
Becker ahead in the count, 2-1. Pitch on the way outside, 3-1. Well, nothing starts it off like a walk. Doesn't matter if 2 outs, no outs, whatever. A walk changes the dynamic of an inning.
Completely. Those free passes, I mean, you can't defend those. There's no defense for 4 balls.
80 pitches now for Sandercock. With a coffee break in there. 3-1 pitch on the way. On the outside corner. I think Enfield was lost in the count. That should have been. Well, what do we got here?
Did we?
Guess he's calling ball 4.
Okay. I thought he called it a strike. It sounded like he said.
Yeah, it was a 3-1 count.
Yeah.
Enfield thought it was the third strike. She threw it around the horn.
Yeah, she thought it was called a strike. He did. He showed strike there, so I'm not sure what happened. There was no illegal pitch shown.
Yeah, I'm not sure. He called the strike. Should be 3-2 count.
Correct.
But then he gives Becker first. So with 2 outs, we have a runner at first. And the Cowgirls live to see Edwards come to the plate. That's a ground ball up the middle past Muffley, and that'll be a single to center. And the Cowgirls are on the run. Look at this. Edwards takes second. What a heads-up play. Center fielder Kerr grab the ball, taking her time, and Edwards full throttle into second.
So Edwards getting that ball off the end of her bat. Was able to get past Muffley. Muffley not playing up the middle as much. And Becker going to third base. And we end up with Edwards on second base.
looks like they're going to maybe review the tag at second.
Okay. And then we have a possible answer for why Becker was awarded first base. Possible delay of game with the throw to from Edenfield down to third base. That's the only thing we can come up with.
The official scorekeeper said walk, so that would go with the pitch delay. Mm-hmm. But he called it clearly. He called a strike.
That's one of those, even in the rule book, I'm not sure I could find that very quickly.
Now, Edwards looked like a basic single.
Yeah.
But her effort and speed
stretched it
to a double.
Yeah.
And that's what we're reviewing right now, the tag at second. But Becker's heads-up play to go from first to third on the play has runners at second and third with two outs in a 7-5 ball game. In a close ball game, how critical is it to make those moves?
Oh, gosh. I mean, that's a gutsy play because Becker on first base going from first to third with the ball hit to center field. It's not like she hit it to right field, so it was an easy play. So we're going to look at this free base for Rachel Becker. So the ball on the outside part of the plate. Umpire clearly calls strike and then awards Becker first base.
So the umpire looks at the third base umpire and then awards first base. And then here's the play at second. Clearly safe.
Oh, yeah, clearly safe.
That's a freshman making a play like that.
Freshman was like, yes!
That's only a good play because it worked.
That's true. That's usually how phenomenal plays go. Hey, it worked.
You know, a freshman making that move. Mm-hmm. Now, it would have been nice to see the first base coach and what that call.
Oh, I'm sure Shippy was like, go.
Kenny Gajewski down there talking to the umpire. Probably still trying to figure out what happened with the Becker. Kylie Naomi up. So you've got Edwards at second, Becker at third. Naomi's up. She hit a double down the left field line last time up. Sandercock getting into a little bit of trouble here in the sixth. All with two outs. Sandercock looked like she was in control of the inning, getting two early ground balls, and then the Cowgirls, a walk, led to a double, and here we are.
And the go-ahead run at home plate.
It's like they're going to intentionally walk the senior.
Okie dokie. To get to work. Rise balls, right?
Inside, high and tight.
Yeah, high and tight. You got to be ready as a runner at third base. You just never know what's going to happen with an intentional walk. If you actually throw it a little bit too high and too far out, you got to be ready to go.
The strategies, the chess pieces continue.
Exactly.
The intentional walk to Naomi. Naomi walks. That's going to put bases loaded, two outs. Work the redshirt freshman. Remember, she played at Kansas last year on deck. She was at Kansas, then she transferred here. And she's going to get a chance
to be the hero, right?
Yeah. To compete and win this, you know, put them up, have a chance to compete in this game. You know, last time, Reed, straight fastballs high and tight. That's ball four. And that will complete the intentional walk.
But it does put players at every base. So all you need to do is tag your base. Like, closest out, that's what you go for if it's in the infield.
You're looking for that drop ball. You're going to have to stay on it.
We'll see how Sandercock pitches work. If she's going to go high and tight or if she's going to go corners.
Great pitchers have so many options.
Work a little bit off the plate here. It's high and tight.
First pitch, high and tight, fouled off.
And those are the ones you cannot hit that ball well. I mean, you've got to hold your hand so far above your head to get on plane with that ball. And then you've got to guess right.
Is she going to be disciplined enough to lay off?
That's true.
That's the key.
Yeah.
Oh, and one. Pitch on the way.
Good discipline there.
1-1.
So does Florida State play the odds and call the high and tight again?
What a big moment, redshirt freshman. Two-time All-American in the circle right now. 1-1 pitch. Change up in there for a cold strike. 1-2. Think of all those options. You got the high and tight. You got the draw ball. You got the change up.
All while, as a batter, you're going, I just need a good strike to swing at. Just give me a good strike to swing at. See where the discipline is with two strikes now.
1-2. Yep. Fouled down the first base line. She stays alive. You step into that box with confidence.
You better. Yeah. You gotta have that on your mind, like, I'm here to be successful. I'm here to make a play. And then the fielders are already prepared for, if the ball's hit to me, what do I do with it?
Probably going the easy way, wherever the ball takes you. 1-2 pitch, popped up, foul. Third baseman makes the play to end the inning. And the Cowgirls strand three here at the bottom of the sixth. 7-5 Florida State. You're watching Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus. Pitch outside, ball one. Two walks, a run for Flaherty at second. She's made some plays defensively.
She's had some great at-bats, that's for sure, too, being very patient.
And a couple stolen bases. Called strike, 1-1. You know, I was fully expecting the stolen bases, to be honest with you. I knew if she got on, she'd be looking to take second.
They'd be sending her.
I guess I didn't expect the aggressive nature through the whole game of taking every extra base.
Yeah.
Now, I did like to see Oklahoma State in the bottom of the sixth try to get back into that action with Edwards.
Right.
1-1 pitch, fouled off. 1-2, Kilfoyle heading the count.
Kilfoyle, that down and out pitch for lefties. You gotta get on top of that just a little bit. Put it in play if it's a strike. That's a tough pitch.
So for tomorrow's game, you're talking Oklahoma State has shown two great pitchers.
Correct.
Florida State has shown two great pitchers.
Correct.
So you're starting to show your cards a little bit. We'll see how it plays out in game two.
Yeah.
1-2 pitch on the way. That ball's hit well to left. Edwards is there. Makes the catch. And what a great job of tracking that ball.
Yeah, you've got to almost take a jump before the ball is hit based on where it is and how the bat is contacting it so you can get a good jump.
At night with the lights, you know, that's a challenge.
It is.
It's good to be at home.
It is good to be at home. Good communication there by Cheyenne Factor and Edwards in left field.
This is Keen. Keen took over at first for Mac Leonard, a senior. Transfer from South Florida. It's going to be her first at bat.
Kilfoyle continuing that outside part of the plate for the lefties.
First pitch in there for a called strike. Keena's done well defensively. Made a couple of plays. One out. Pitch on the way, fouled off.
So if I'm a hitter and I know that Kilfoyle's pitching outside and low, I'm going to go ahead and put my toes on that chalk line as close as to home plate as I can, see if I can get more of a barrel on the ball.
You know, at this point in the game, the batter's box has kind of been wiped out.
There's no chalk lines all that much. You're just guessing.
0-2 pitch inside. 1-2, but is that better for the hitter?
Gosh. I think you make your adjustments based on the pitcher in the strike zone. I'm not sure that as a hitter, you make your decision based on where the chalk lines are. I mean, as a slapper, you absolutely would. Because if you get called out of the box, you're like, what box? It doesn't exist anymore.
1-2. Fouled off. You know, as a slapper, though, most of the time by the second inning, that whole front part of the box is completely gone.
Gone. We're not going to see a lot of slappers in the Big 12. They tend to like to hit bombs instead.
You know, one thing Kenny says about Oklahoma State and is that they can win in a variety of ways.
Right.
Florida State the same way. They have so much talent. They can produce runs mm-hmm. if they need to play small ball, if they need to be aggressive on the base paths. The 1-2 pitch popped up. That's going to be in foul territory. Naomi makes the catch for the second out. Speed, confidence, knowing the ballpark, a lot of room down the foul territory.
Yeah, Naomi had to cover a lot of ground there. So down and out. Keen just gets under that ball, and you can see Naomi hightailing it there. And as an outfielder, you've got to understand, okay, if I can't get to that ball, I want to make sure my infield knows, like, you got to take that ball. I'm not there. So that communication has to be key.
Edenfield, three-run bomb earlier in this game. Really kind of set things in motion for this ball game. Two outs, digs in, pitch outside. One ball, no strikes. 7-5 game. Just look at her, the focus she has stepping in.
Oh, yeah. As a hitter this late in the game, you've got to go back to the last time you had a good swing and remember what that felt like and put it into practice. That muscle memory has to be key.
Interesting dynamic for Florida State. You go up and you're sitting at a 4-0 lead.
Comfortably, yeah.
Yeah, you feel like you've got the game at this point. You got your All-American in the circle. You give it up. You give up four runs. It's tied. And you think, okay, now what's going to happen? Mentally, they continue to fight back and pick up some runs late.
Yeah.
I mean, momentum, being on the road, everything was going towards Oklahoma State. Florida State continued to battle.
When I think moving forward, both teams will have that impression of it's never enough. We don't ever have enough runs. We have to continue putting the pressure on.
2-1 count now to Edenfield. I've been impressed with Edenfield behind the plate, framing pitches, helping the pitchers along. 2-1 pitch. Outside, 3-1. Muffley on deck. Three-one pitcher, trying not to leave something up.
Definitely don't want to pitch Edenfield too good.
Outside, ball four. So she'll draw the base on ball. She'll head down to first. That's her second consecutive walk. Two outs on the board. Muffley, who's 0-3. Probably take your chances. Edenfield, take the walk. Go face Muffley, who's 0-3.
When you get Muffley another at bat to see, let's get her confidence up for tomorrow. If she can get a hit, feels a little bit better going into tomorrow.
P pitch on the way. Called strike. So Kilfoyle up in the count. Florida State looking to add some insurance runs here late.
And I would say, I would say they probably need them because you just never know what next inning, what the bottom of the inning is going to bring. Oklahoma State could just come up swinging the bats really, really hard.
Pitch outside, 1-1. Due up for Oklahoma State in the bottom of the seventh. 5, 6, and 7. Carwile factor win. Kilfoyle trying to give the hitters a chance. One pitch. That ball's hit well to right. Carwile's there, makes the catch for the third out. As we'll head to the bottom of the seventh. Florida State up 7-5. You're watching Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus. Again, it starts with base runners.
Yeah. One at a time, but you're running out of time.
Now is the time for the Cowgirls. Still not much win.
Yeah, you do have to start with that first batter. You got to get on. Got to get your job done no matter what it takes. Bunt it, hit it, an error. You have to make it happen.
Carwell does have a walk today. Last time she reached on fielder's choice. Pitch in there for a strike.
You can see that ball just dropped.
93 pitches now for Sandercock. Pitch on the way, fouled off. 0-2. What are you thinking now, 0-2 in the count?
0-2. Man, if she throws me another drop ball, I'm going to make sure my hands are on plane with it. At this point, I'm not guessing, I'm reacting. And if I've done my job up until now, I understand the release points and how she's gripping the ball. So there shouldn't be any surprises.
0-2. Ball. Sandercock coming out of the circle again, yeah. Thinking it was a called strike three.
I mean, it looked like a good pitch. Let's look and see where that ball ended up. It looked like it could have caught the corner. I think Carwell did hold up. I mean, barely, maybe.
They did check with the umpire
they
third.
Did. Yeah.
One ball, two strikes.
Better make this at bat count.
Pitch low and inside, 2-2. Coach Alameda stepping out of the dugout, making the calls. Two pitch coming up. Foul down the first baseline. Wind is starting to pick up a little bit from center to left. A little bit of wind. Everybody's still here.
Now, if I'm Carwell, I'm taking my cue off of Muffley at shortstop. She's playing deep towards second base. So I'm thinking, okay, I might get another inside pitch.
2-2 count coming up. Outside, ball three.
Good thing I didn't take the cue from Muffley, right?
So many options. I love the comment about reacting. Getting in there, you have full count. Trust your mechanics,
trust your instincts. If you're gonna take a hack, make it a big one.
Two pitch, ball four.
Walk. Lead off batter, walk.
Lead off walk.
Could come back to bite you.
That'll bring up factor. Cheyenne Factor has a RBI run score.
Tying run at home plate.
Hitting 383, one home run, 16 RBIs. Cowgirls need two to tie as they sit trailing 7-5.
Sandra Crockett at 99 pitches.
Number 100 on the way, called strike. Back-to-back hitters, she started with that called strike.
Yeah. I think Factor did a good job of not swinging at that one. You want something a little bit better with no strikes.
She just gave up the walk.
Yeah.
Pitch on the way.
Change up.
0-2.
Up 0-2 quickly.
Now you're protecting.
You have to protect, exactly. And you want to put it in play somewhere where it's not going to be a double play.
See what Carlisle does at first here with 0-2 count. Pitch inside. She was more bailing out of the box.
Yeah.
And they're saying she went around. The appeal says no.
Yeah, we're going to take a look and see exactly where the bat is on this. She tried everything she could, didn't she? Whew.
One ball, two strikes. I wouldn't do it again.
No.
Pitch on the way, fouled off. One and two. She was kind of dialed in on that.
I think she wanted that one. It's good she got a piece of it.
We're really trying, whatever you do, trying to avoid the double play here with no outs.
Yeah. Let's see if Sandra Hawk goes back to that outside pitch. Moving that ball in and out has been her bread and butter today.
Pitch high, 2-2.
That's a good call with Factor holding up on that rise ball just last time.
Similar as bad as Carlisle.
Yeah.
Ahead in the count. Foul off a couple pitch. Led to a walk.
Yeah. Battled back to 2-2.
Factor's played in a lot of games for the Cowgirls. Pitch high. 3-2. Second consecutive batter with full counts.
And if you guys are keeping track, this game is almost 3.5 hours long.
Well, Allie, we don't get to do very many games together, so
that's
if we're going to do it, let's just do it
count
for a while. Yeah.
And we got another one tomorrow together.
There you go. You're trying to look at the stance and the way she's set up in the box.
Yeah, I was wondering if she's a little bit far off the plate.
3-2 pitch. Ground ball up the middle. Sandercock fields it to second in time to first for the double play. And Sandercock gets the ground ball that she was looking for, makes the play.
Yeah. She has the presence of mind to make sure that she turned the right way to get an aggressive throw to second base. She doesn't even hesitate on that one. Now, there was a little bit of confusion of whether Flaherty or Muffley were going to take that throw.
Look at Flaherty plant that back foot and fire across to first. So on the 1-4-3 double play, puts two outs on the board, and Oklahoma State has Morgan Wynn at the plate and down to their last out.
Down to their last out. And Morgan Wynn tends to take that ball down the middle of the plate for a strike on her first pitch.
You called it.
That one was a changeup, so that one's okay. But yes, a little bit more aggressive.
Now you're trying to rally with two outs. Deflating double play.
Oof, yes.
Trail 7-5.
The pitch confidence high. Factor goes back, swings towards Florida State. That is a deflating double play.
One count. What I thought were two pretty good at-bats for the Cowgirls to start this inning.
They battled back from 0-2 all the way back to full count.
1-1 pitch. 2-1.
Gwynn definitely knows where she wants that ball, and she's got a great eye.
Sandercock taking her time. Looking in. 2-1 pitch. Outside 3-1. She's done three balls on all three hitters. Still feel like Oklahoma State would be alive and get the walk.
Right.
You're one swing away from tying it up.
Right. With two outs, you've got to be a team that can put runners on and score with two outs. That's tough to do for anybody.
3-1, big swing and a miss. 3-2. Let's see who's on deck down there. Tuck, catcher. So full count pitch coming up. Third straight batter here in the seventh. This could be the ball game. Pitch on the way, swing and a miss, and that'll do it. Florida State takes game one, 7-5, and improves to 21-3. Oklahoma State falls to 18-2. And a heck of a ball game, a long ball game, but a lot of action as Florida State pulls out game one, 7-5.
Yeah, and they broke Oklahoma State's winning streak, stays at 16, goes back down to nothing again. Sandercock came in at the end of the game, started the game, finished the game, did well.
Florida State moves to 12 straight wins, so they'll move to 12 straight. We'll play it again tomorrow, 2:00 Central Time. Same two teams, Oklahoma State, Florida State.
We'll be
a great series.
We'll be looking for each team to make those adjustments to come.